This episode of the Primal Scream Podcast is brought to you by It Works independent distributor Kathy Scala. Have you tried that crazy rap thing? It tightens, tones, and firms any area from the neck down. It Works also provides a wide variety of premium supplements, along with a full skincare line. I personally use their multivitamins and greens. And if you're interested in learning more about It Works products or the business opportunity, call or text Kathy at 319-360-2009 or go to her website, kathyscala.myitworks.com. That's kathyscala.myitworks.com.
All right, we want to thank our sponsor, Sauce Hockey. I love Sauce Hockey because they have super unique clothing. It's all kind of hockey-based, but it's not part of any hockey program, so to speak. It's got, like, cool sayings on their shirts and, again, the most comfortable shirts ever. They have fantastic hats. They have fedoras. They have baseball caps. They have all kinds of stuff. This is a wonderful, wonderful company. We wish them the best because we'd like them to be picked up by the NHL someday. But until then, there's that wonderful little company that everybody loves to get the best freaking t-shirts in the world from. I just love how comfy they are. Do you like their t-shirts as well?
I love all their stuff.
Good. All right. So Sauce Hockey, please pick them up. We want to thank our next sponsor, Ecolips. They're one of our absolute favorites. Steve Shriver, Entrepreneur of the Year for Iowa. It's his company. They are organic. They're vegan, if you would like. They have some wonderful, wonderful flavors. They can make just about anything you want because they have this incredible thing called create your own Ecolips called My Ecolips. So they can put different flavors, different containers, different coats on the outside so you can see what they look like and have your name and be flashy. But they just do wonderful, wonderful stuff. And I personally appreciate the Mongo Lip, which has mint and peppermint, kind of a minty hemp oil kind of thing. I just think it's freaking fantastic. Do you like, what's your favorite?
You said Mongo Kiss.
Mongo Kiss.
I like the Mongo Kiss. I also like the One World.
Oh, yeah.
The One World Mint.
That eco container.
Yeah, I really enjoy that.
Me too. So please go to ecolips.com and you can check out all their stuff. Steve Shriver's wonderful little daughter has a great video on there as well. So check out Ecolips, ecolips.com.
Another sponsor that we have is Sweet Rod Joy. Go to sweetrodjoy.com. Check it out. Their website is Desserts to Live For.
They're so freaking yummy.
I love Sweet Rod Joy because when you are trying to watch what you eat, trying to eat healthy, but you need something sweet. All of us have those midnight cravings that are super sweet and we want to get rid of that.
This also goes one step further. You know why?
Why?
Because you don't even have to worry about those things. You want something sweet. You want to, you're thinking about maybe having some, you know, regular convection sugar kind of thing. This stuff is easily a dessert that you should eat anytime you want to when you want something sweet. Not just because it's raw, because it tastes fantastic.
And it's super filling. So things that you would normally just sit and eat the whole bag of, you simply can't do that with Sweet Raw Joy. You have a couple pieces of their fudge, boom, you're done. You're full.
Love it.
So go to sweetrawjoy.com and check out your own desserts today. One of our sponsors who helps us out quite a bit is Penguins Comedy Club. Go to penguinscomedyclub.com and you will see all of their comedians for that week that are going to be performing. So if you don't know what you're going to be doing in the Cedar Rapids area, go to penguinscomedyclub.com and check them out. Also, if you want to schedule an entertainer or you need an entertainer for your company or business or get together, go to usaentertainmentagency.com. Our great friend Jeff Johnson runs that, and
he hooks us up with great comedians all the time. We haven't had one yet that hasn't been a blast to talk to.
So you need somebody for entertainment, you need somebody for weddings, festivals, fairs, corporate, media, whatever.
I want Doug Thompson at a Renaissance festival. That would be great.
How wonderful would that be? Anyway, go to usaentertainmentagency.com to check out more information and get a hold of Jeff Johnson.
Thanks, Jeff.
Wake up. It's time for Primal Scream.
Hey,
I'm Matt.
Hey, I'm Todd.
And welcome back to the Primal Scream Podcast.
It'll seem a little odd because this is actually going to be at the beginning of the podcast, but we're actually doing it at the end. After Mike Armstrong and Jeff Johnson have left. But we didn't get a chance to do it in the beginning. But I tell you what, that was one. You'll get to enjoy one fucking great podcast.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Stay along for the whole thing because it gets better as it goes. It's kind of like a fine wine.
It is a really good, one. So.
Enjoy this episode of the Problem Screen Podcast with Mike Armstrong.
Boom. Jeff's done a great job of getting us awesome comedians and people on our show. How did you get started in comedy? I mean, I hate to say this. I think I had only one other, like, I consider old school kind of comic, and that would be Dan Chopin. And you, how did you get started? When you,
I was actually working off duty on the police department,
okay,
at a mall, and it was Lent, so I was making fun of everybody because I'm Catholic.
Okay.
Kentucky's like 70% Catholic.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, everybody thinks we're like dirt floor rattlesnake, you know, people right. from the Discovery Channel, but we're not. We're right. Catholics. And I just was telling everybody to give up fish on Fridays for Lent and all that kind of stuff. I mean, just messing with everybody. Somebody walked by and I'd mock them. And a guy came up to me and he goes, you know, we just opened up a comedy club here. You ought to come down and do open mic.
How long ago was this?
About 22 years ago.
Wow. Okay.
Maybe I didn't know longer. I forget.
Well, I mean, I've known Jeff for for a good chunk of time?
Yeah. His time. Birth certificate just says dirt. Where the now I'm older than he.
Well, I mean, part of that, that, I mean, somebody heard you be funny. And that's kind of how it started. Because, I mean, your cop stuff is part of a lot of your bits that I've seen.
Yeah. It's really a small part.
Right, you know, but most of the YouTube clips have that minutes. Cop part.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I was married and I'm divorced now and got a bunch of kids. And,
How many kids do you have?
Five.
Wow.
But they're all grown and gone.
Sure.
Supposedly.
They're supposed to be.
Yeah, they're supposed to be gone. You never get rid of them.
Right.
Man. I mean, they're gone, but I still pay their bills.
Oh. It's a good dad. I got one in the Air Force, so he's paying his own bills.
I got two sons that are Army Rangers.
Okay.
And one son, he's pretty close to becoming a priest.
So, oh, wow.
Yeah. They all want you to go to heaven a different way, apparently. You're going to get there. Whether it's a long time, unless you're laying in a hospital, or it's just one real quick, huh?
Yeah, exactly. Bam. Have you seen American Sniper?
No, I'm afraid I'll cry too much.
Oh, because it just worries you?
Yeah, they've both been to Afghanistan. They were both hurt. And I'm just... it took me forever to watch Lone Survivor. And
Well, when you read the book, too. The book is a great book to read. And then you see the movie, you're just like, wow, they did a good job of capturing kind of that.
Yeah, I said, I'm going to have to be alone when I watch it. Because whenever they're overseas, whenever they're in Afghanistan or Africa or wherever they go, I won't answer the door.
Oh, I bet.
I'm petrified.
That's got to be a horrible worry all the time. I mean,
it's just, you know, you haven't heard from them for 2 weeks, and then, you know, all of a sudden the doorbell rings and somebody's delivering you something.
Right.
And then eventually you go out there and you find a package.
Jesus, shit your pants.
Well, those flowers aren't going to make it.
It's scary. It's hard on the family.
That's
going to
be horrible.
Oh, yeah. You know?
Well, we have a good friend of ours who's a trainer here for a CrossFit gym, and he's done 3 or 4 tours in Afghanistan and Iraq. And he thought it was okay, American Sniper. He thought it was all right. He said a harder movie for him to watch, though, was Fury. He said, because
my sons loved that.
And he said he was in combat, and he said that it was something he could handle and it was tangible. He said, but trying to wrap his head around the idea of almost like Revolutionary War, standing and shooting at each other kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like World War II, these guys in tanks just taking shots at each other until the other guy gets the better shot off. He said it was just almost too much stress for him.
And see, my son said that Lone Survivor was more realistic than them.
Okay.
Because they'd been in battles where they'd been outnumbered.
Oh, okay.
And they were like – and they said it was kind of like a high for them, you know.
Oh, I'm sure it is. Well, you're in survival mode. You got adrenaline pumping through your body.
And
he
said they're all making jokes and, you know, and going, make sure, you know, you got this so they can identify you. And then they'd all laugh, you know.
Right. Well, I think you have to handle stress different ways, right? I mean, that's I've had friends who you tell them somebody's passed away. Like, I had a friend in my early 20s. I went to a buddy's house and said, hey, so-and-so got a car accident last night and died. And he just started laughing. And that's how
that's
he
kind
handled
of the way
it,
they you know? Are too, but they're the most congenial people at sure. the same time.
Exactly.
And see, I got a cousin that's a Navy SEAL, and or he was. So he asked my son, he goes, what do you Rangers do? He goes, well, we come in at night because we're airborne.
Right.
He said, we come in, we kill the enemy, we kick open the door and say, dry those little eyes, Navy SEAL. I'm taking you home.
Oh, God.
There's got to be some battles.
No, holy you know shit. What?
They're it's all friendly. One. Oh, yeah.
You know, that's just like point. Your son's in the Air Force. See, I got another nephew that's in the Air Force.
He probably gets a lot of shit.
Oh, yeah. Because for me, I always go, you know, I've never seen an Air Force tent in the middle of a desert.
Yeah. And you won't.
I mean, the first thing they build is the pool.
My son wanted to be in the Army.
Oh, really?
And I had to get Matt. And I had to get two of my other buddies, along with this trainer from the gym. We all went out to dinner one night, and they're all old Army Rangers. They're all like, don't be a dumbass. Go to the Air Force. Better pay, better living conditions, better food.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that kind of thing. They're like, come on. If you can do 4 years, just go and do your time. We appreciate it, but you don't have to go into the Army kind of thing.
You need everybody.
Yeah, exactly. But, I mean, I sure appreciate all, people who are willing to do that. Yeah,
when it comes down to it.
All right, let's get back to comedy. I sorry I went down that track, but
no.
So you're from Louisville, Kentucky.
Louisville, Kentucky. You said it right. Nice. Almost.
Louisville.
Louisville.
Louisville. Louisville.
Yeah,
okay.
After King Louis.
Oh yeah. Exactly. I remember that guy. Well, it's like saying New Orleans instead of New Orleans. Yeah. Say New Orleans. So yeah. And I mean, I have friends from Mississippi, so I think that's where I picked that up from. But so you were born and raised.
I was born and raised in a little town outside of Louisville. Little farm town, but then I moved there, and then when things started going good, I bought the big house there and okay. all that kind of good stuff.
Good as in you were doing comedy, or were you?
Yeah,
a cop?
I was doing comedy, okay. And I got on Bob and Tom, and they produced my first CD, and,
oh, wow.
and gave me all the money. I mean, all the money.
Oh, that's
and
awesome!
I had enough to buy a big house. Really,
good for you.
Yeah, and then I lost it when I got divorced.
Yeah, that's the way it goes.
You know, I don't care. You know, I got a condo in Louisville now, and I got the lake house in Georgia. Up
oh,
now,
nice.
So I'm good.
Oh, my goodness. That sounds beautiful.
And Jeff will keep working me. I will get that
I think
condo.
You're gonna be, it sounds like you're going to be pretty. You're in pretty safe hands.
There you go.
It sounds like you do awfully
you
well,
know what?
So that's
He's the
great.
Greatest guy in the world, Jeff Johnson.
Yes.
And, thank you. Appreciate that.
And you are. Yeah. And
he's a wonderful guy. He has done wonders for us, so we really appreciate him.
You know, and it's
bit.
Really weird, and I'm not sucking up to him either.
I am a little bit. Just
oh, okay. Well, I mean, I'll help you out. I know him. I'll put in a good word for it.
That's, I appreciate it. That's nice of you.
But he's got a reputation. Everybody trusts him.
Right.
You know? I've seen him actually say, well, I'll take it out of my pocket, you know? And I go, no, I'm not going to do that, you know? Other agents, they squeak when they walk. They're
right.
So cheap, you know.
Well, and I heard Joe Rogan the other day on his podcast talking about there's certain clubs and circuits where people just don't want to go anymore.
I won't go.
Because they'll you know, what do you have for a local open mic night? What do you have for these certain things? And I was like, oh, no, we only bring in headliners. We only do these certain things. Like, well, how are you going
to
cultivate a good
and they
right.
don't
comedy
pay
culture?
You.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and they're going, it's just like some people go, oh, come on down to Florida. It'd be like a vacation. No, when I take a vacation, I don't do 7 shows in 4 days.
Right.
You know and no, I'm not doing it. And yeah. I got the luxury of saying no.
Sure.
I do right. have that. And I will in a heartbeat.
Sure.
Well, it's sometimes not in a nice way.
Yeah, there's a lot of people though that you know want that because they don't have they're not set up and not making a ton of money. So they'll be like,
sure,
well, I'll go to Hawaii and work. They'll pay my airfare, my hotel, but they're not going to pay me anything.
Yeah,
you know, they don't. Gotcha. They literally try to get you for to pay nothing.
Yeah,
and it's like, well, you can use it as a vacation. It's like I'm over here working.
Yeah,
right.
Because I mean, your day's screwed up because you're doing right. radio shows, you're doing local TV, you're doing whatever. And you really have no time
right.
to yourself.
Well, and I think that idea, the business aspect of things, I'm sure it's totally different than what we do. But doing this podcast, Matt's talked to people where they're like, you need to make sure your chart – when we have people come in, we produce shows for them or commercials. You need to make sure you're doing how much they're charging you studio time, then you're charging editing time, and you're charging them all these little pieces where we're thinking like, oh, well, pay us this much money and we'll take care of everything. It's like you need to make sure you take all your work that you do down to the dollar and the cents so you can keep track of it better. And we're like, well, oh, shit, we never thought about
I think
that.
The cheaper the job, the more they want you to put out too. I mean, you can do a job for $5,000 and they're like just happy you showed up. You do one for $300 and they're like calling you every 5 days and going, you know, are you going to do this? Are you going to do that? Hey, we want you to come in the morning and shake hands with everybody.
Right.
As they're getting out of bed, you know, and they're going, you know, you're going, geez.
Now, I know Bob and Tom from their show on the radio.
Yeah.
But how long have Bob and Tom been around, and how did you get involved with them?
I was doing comedy, and I was in Greenwood, Indiana, and Tom had seen me on a poster or something. And he walked up to me, and he said, are you the comedian over at One Liners? And I said, yeah. He said, why don't you come on our show tomorrow? So I go on the show and just ate it. Bad. Oh, I mean,
by the way, this is Matt.
Hey, hey, glad you showed up for your show.
I knew I wouldn't have to say anything. That's awesome. Thank you so much for that.
Well, the buses weren't running on time.
Exactly.
Todd is like, finally.
Somebody gets it in the ass.
You know what? He's over my height limit. Just let me get to my car, man. Make it even. God, I'd hate to shoot him. That would make him mad.
So what do you think? You think you was kind of the start was when you went on their show? Is that when you felt like it?
And then I ate it so bad. I knew I ate it because after the first break, they went, hey, thanks for coming.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's too bad.
Oh, and I knew it. And I walked out, and it didn't bother me. I went, well, so be it. And then I came back about 4 months later to do something, and they invited me back on again. See, I never talked about being an ex-cop. Never.
Oh, okay.
And then as I'm doing the show, somebody called and said, hey, ask Mike about the time he shot that guy's finger off.
All right. I saw that one.
And then they go, what'd you used to do? And then I told them, and then it went from there. And then they said, hey, come back tomorrow, which I've never done before.
Wow. Well, I mean, for lack of a better term, it is a pretty good shtick. I mean, you don't see a lot of ex-cops
I didn't want to talk about it.
Oh, okay.
Because I just never did want to talk about it.
But you turned it into something funny, though.
And now I have. Now that's how I make my money. I got to make the sign of the cross every time I say their names now. I really do. And the house that I had built, I put a brick in and it said the house that Bob and Tom built.
Really? Nice. That's great. Well, hey, that's nice that you appreciate what they did for you. That's fantastic.
Jeff would have never heard of me if it hadn't been for Bob and Tom.
Right.
I mean, nobody would have. I'd have probably went back on the police department.
Really?
Because it was getting that bad where I couldn't make any money at all doing comedy.
Okay. And how long were you on the police department? How
12
long
years.
You did that for 12 years.
Yeah.
I work with a lot of ex-cops right now, and I was thinking—
psychological, or you're a sociologist?
he
wishes he was a psychologist. Yeah. He does oil changes.
Big line tonight. I couldn't make it.
Too many accusations.
Want windshield wipers. He's smiling, so that's good.
Oh, he is pretty laid back. You're pretty safe.
Yeah, you're safe. You're safe.
I'm laid
if he
back
hits
too.
Anybody, it'll be me. So
oh,
you're,
cool.
You're good to go. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd enjoy watching that. You're a big guy, too. Me and Jeff sit there and drink our soft drinks. Y'all got popcorn?
I see that you brought, and again, I'm sorry that I'm coming in late. I see you brought some... Sweet Raw Joy, did you bring any refresh? Oh, look at right down here. I'm all ready to go right down
He's
here.
He's professional, Mister.
Taking care of business, buddy.
What kind of beer is that?
I don't. It's one I've never had yet. A double hopped IPA from Small 471.
See, I thought it was a sponsor. I was trying to help you.
Oh, no. Oh,
I was doing a lead in. Well, I don't know.
And that's why I don't have them as sponsors.
Yeah. Oh, well, someday it'd be awesome. Have a
beer
sponsor.
Next week they're going to go, you know, the show starts at 10 and you'll be watching. It'll all be over with by the time you get here.
Yeah,
we
exactly.
wanted to keep our sponsors.
You got it. Did you have some? Do you want to? We didn't. Do you want to do the intro really quick? We started about 10 minutes ago. We're pretty safe. I said, but we can just do the intro. You want to do it later on? At some point, do you want to do it?
What all did you go over?
Nothing. We talked.
We went over everything.
We're almost done.
Well, it started at 3:30.
I repositioned cameras. I got Jeff in. I got everything good. Everything's recording. We've covered where he lives, Louisville, Kentucky.
Yeah.
His kids, has a bunch of kids in the military. We talked a little bit about that.
He's got a son in the military.
And I let him know you were also in the military. And that was about it.
I didn't know you were in the military.
Yeah, he was in the Army.
I don't look it.
No, you do. I'm surprised you're not biting those caps off the tire.
Too many caps. Those caps are expensive.
You're not mixing those beers in one glass, are you?
I guess those are two different beers.
Yeah. Oh, is it? You asked for a conglomeration.
I had
beers,
kind of a rough day at work. I told the guy that I carpool with, who was the reason why I'm late, I go, I'm not even going to taste the first two. I probably won't even taste the first two beers. He's like, oh, fuck. Tough day. But it's I'm really glad to have you here.
What military branch was your
name? I was in the Army.
Oh, really?
At the 82nd Airborne.
There you go.
So I used to jump out of planes, and I'm glad that was over.
Yeah, my son just graduated from Airborne. I'm surprised.
Oh, did he really?
Well, I got two sons that are Airborne, but I'm surprised they let them become Rangers before they became Airborne.
So they went
Ranger, then Airborne.
Really?
Yeah. They got everything new now.
So right, because the way that it was set up when I went through was you get done with basic, and then you have the option. You can volunteer to go through airborne school.
Well, see, right? Now you really don't have the option because too many people want to do it. They pick you.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and you're lucky if you get in.
Huh. Wow. Because they were kind of I had the impression they were trying to phase that airborne stuff out because we have the whole reason for a paratrooper is to take over a landing strip or an airport quickly. And now with the machinery that we have and the airplanes that we have, you can fast rope in with you know from helicopters.
Yeah, I know what the fuck you're talking about.
I don't know.
I have to act like I'm some dumbass, and I've seen enough movies. I know what you're talking about. Okay, like ninjas. I get it.
Well, yeah. Well, now everybody has a beret and...
Yeah, you know, and that's my son. He's like, oh, both of them are just like hyped up over the beret stuff. They go, if you don't earn the cover, you shouldn't wear it.
Right. Yeah. And then there's reasons why there's certain color berets. And when somebody walks down the street, somebody with just a cap... A field cap on is looking over going, oh, yeah, that guy's in the 82nd. Or, oh, they have a black beret on. They're Rangers. Yeah, or whatever, you know? So there's that point of pride that has kind of gotten lost.
Well, now they're getting – I was told by a junior that they're going to get all the uniforms to be all similar colors. They're all the same
across
thing.
Across the
board. Yeah. And you'll have a US different Navy. Badge that says what branch you're in, but they're all going to be the same colors. So that's even more nondescript.
Well – Who really needs to have white and blue on as a Navy?
Yeah.
Well, you don't really need to camouflage yourself. You're on a big fucking boat.
Right.
Well, what if there's a killer catfish?
That's right. You might have that.
Noodling.
Came a lot of
heavy noodling.
Starboard bound.
I'm going to take some of that. I'm hungry.
What is it?
Has he not offered you any of this?
No, I'm trying to get you to plug the sponsor.
He's trying to help you out.
Setting you up again.
And I'm like, whip. You're softball pitching me these things. This is Sweet Raw Joy. Sweet Raw Joy, if you go to sweetrawjoy.com, they have desserts to live for is their motto. And these are unbaked desserts.
They look very good.
They are delicious. I want you can try one.
I just got done eating.
Okay, all right.
Yesterday. Sponsor gone.
You can tell I'm from the South. I forgot. I've done 18. I'm not eating. We don't put a G on nothing. We really don't.
Eating nothing.
Nothing.
Now what are you doing over there? You really need me, don't you? I'm like your training wheels. That's what I am to you. I was watching a bunch of your videos today. The cop thing, I have never, well, I shouldn't say never, very rarely do I ever see a comedian who can come across as extremely masculine or from a tough background as far as, I should say, like a serious background, like a cop or a military person. And I've always seen like, other comedians come have a much easier time being funny, silly, goofy if they don't have a serious type of background. But you made the cop thing very hilarious.
Well, you know, I act like I'm – every time I do a show, I pretend I'm in my driveway talking to my best friends, and it makes it easier. And I'm just telling stories.
Yeah. You
know? And when I'm talking about my ex-wife or my kids, I just pretend I'm talking to whoever.
But the one bit that you had about, you know, pulling somebody over and them asking you, don't you have anything better to do? I like that one. It's such a real moment. You know, I think back when I've been pulled over, I've heard other people say that to cops. And if you really did ever comment to them.
I used to smart off and they'd go, why aren't you out catching real criminals? I'd go, I'm not that good at this job. You know, and I tell him,
I would have a really hard time being pissed at a cop who's making me laugh like that.
I go, I'm trying to get disability without actually hurting myself. I used to say, and if a girl would go, like, push her boobs together,
yeah,
I'd go, you know, I have a top just like that. But I think I look better.
So let me ask you this. Yeah. On the way home, a cop was in the car with me, and mm-hmm. I said, What did you do as a cop that you maybe don't think people know that you did? He goes, well, if it was a really attractive woman, I would prolong the ticket.
And see, I wouldn't write one.
Wow.
Yeah. No, he said he would still write him one, but it would just take a long, long time.
Well, see, that just makes him madder.
But he, yeah, but how do you observe? Did you ever take your time observing?
No, I never wrote one.
You're not getting it.
That's what I tell people. I go, my tickets were yellow. They were so old. And I go, you better mail it before it falls apart, you know? Because I just didn't believe in tickets. I used to make, like, if I caught a kid and they're going 50, 60 over the speed limit, which a lot of them do when they get their driver's license,
mm-hmm.
I just make them pee in their pants.
Just make them nervous as hell.
No, I'd say pee in your pants and I'll let you go. I'd say I can't let you off the hook completely. You're not going to learn.
I have to shame you in some way.
Soil yourself right now.
It's up to you. Lose your car insurance, feel the wrath of your parents, or pee in your pants. And they go, I'll pee in my pants. I go, now I want to see a puddle.
Now, I don't know if he's kidding or not.
Who are they going to tell?
I don't know if he's kidding or not. I don't know.
Who are they going to tell?
Just recently, my mom held a teenager captive, in a way. In a way. Well,
does Bubby want you to talk about this on the air?
He's here for the jury. Not in a way.
Well, because she was supposed to be watching her grandson, my nephew, okay? And he was supposed to be at her house, and he said, Bubby, I have some errands to run. I got to go hang out with some of my friends. She said, fine, be home by 10. No problem. She calls him at 10 because he's not there. No answer. 10:30, no answer. 11 o'clock, no answer. She's calling, 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 no answer. She finally decides she's going to drive to where the parents live. And the whole street is full with cars. There's no place to park. She's walking around the house. All the lights are on, just packed shoulder to shoulder in there. Party, beer everywhere. She walks into the basement, clears everybody out. But the kid had done it pretty well. He had gone through the house, took all the valuables, put it in his sister's room, locked the door. He had done things pretty well. And then his buddies come back after everybody's scared and takes off. A handful of friends come back, help him clean up. The next day, a loser shows up. Some real little douchebag. My mom answers the door. He goes, my bag is here. I need to get my bag. She goes, does it look like this? She picks up this bag. He goes, yeah, it's got my shoes and some pants. And she goes, yeah, I'll give it to you as soon as you call your parents. I want to see you call your parents right now and tell them why I'm holding your bag. He goes, you can't do that. She goes, yeah, actually, I can. I'm holding it. I can do this. I'm doing it right now. Call him. And he had to call her. He had to call his parents. It's like, awesome. How many parents do that? How many parents hold those kids accountable or
nowadays,
make them piss their pants?
Nowadays, it doesn't happen at all. You know, they get off. I know too many kids that are just like have never learned a lesson.
Well, see, I always told my kids, whatever you do, you're getting blamed for it because I know nobody can talk you into anything.
Right.
So you're getting the full wrath of whatever happens.
You made some choices.
Yep.
That's the way it goes.
Now, Mike, did Todd tell you that normally we play some Cards Against Humanity?
No.
You what's wrong? What's going on? It's because I'm not here. It's the training wheels.
You
it?
Should realize that all cameras are running and all sound is recording.
Which means that I'm so safe right now. I'm totally safe.
Which means that there are certain things that I just like, fuck it, we're not doing it.
Well, you know what we can do right now? I'd love to play a couple rounds of Cards Against Humanity.
Okay.
Which, not necessarily a sponsor, but we'd love to have them on the show, and they gave us the okay to play this.
I just love this because the last conversation we had, yeah, I'm kind of over the Cards Against Humanity.
Yeah, you know, it's,
and I'm thinking that, you know, we don't have to do rough. So many rounds of
have
it.
Have you ever played Cards Against Humanity?
No.
Have you ever played Apples to Apples?
No.
All right. Well, we're going to explain to you the rules of this.
Okay.
And it's a normally we do this at the beginning of the show.
We're doing one round.
We're going to do one round. All right.
Okay. How many cards you get?
Normally you get 10 white cards and you... And normally we don't deal out the black cards. You would just take your turn.
Okay.
But it's kind of like, what's the...
Is that five apiece?
Yeah, we have five right now. Okay. Yeah, we're not going to go enough. The full 10 because we're just doing one round. Nope.
Okay.
But anyway...
You're not getting it even if you want it.
Yeah, you can look at your white cards. Because these are the responses. The black cards are statements. And you got to fill in the blank, right?
Okay.
And who's ever's reading the card, they are the judge. Whoever's reading the black card.
It's extremely inappropriate.
Extremely inappropriate.
Oh, yeah. Sexist, I can see very that, racist. Right?
And so, Todd, you did tell him this is an explicit show. You don't have to swear. If it comes out, don't worry about it. And he also told you that at any time, if you need to use the restroom, it's right back there. Right?
Yep.
Did you turn
to the left?
You
turned to the left.
Right. Now, the official rule of Cards Against Humanity when you begin playing is...
It's a real rule.
Legit. Who had the most recent bowel movement?
4 o'clock.
4:30.
Oh! Are you...
Jeff, not yet today?
No, it's earlier than that.
Okay, because I haven't yet.
So. Oh, jeez. Hold on.
Whoa. You got to take a break. You let us know, right?
If I have to.
No squeakers. All right, so that means that Mike won.
All right, so what you have to do is you read the black card.
Okay.
Okay? And then we will... Then you'll shut your eyes and we'll throw some white cards at you without harming you.
Okay.
And then you read your black card again with the white responses, and then you pick whatever one touches your funny bone.
Okay.
All right?
Okay, for my next trick, I will pull blank out of blank.
Ooh, it's a twofer. All right. Maybe you should have given us more than five cards.
Okay.
Nah, you can do it.
That's
all
right. All right, hold on.
Kiss my ass.
Can you read that again for me, please?
For my next trick, I will pull blank out of blank.
Oh, okay. Awesome. Now... When people slide you over these twofers, when you read them, top one is the first response, bottom second.
Okay.
All right, or else they might not make sense. Go ahead and close your eyes, because you can't know where they're coming from.
Okay.
The game cannot be rigged. Jeff is looking for a great response. He's got some terrible cards.
He doesn't feel very good about it. You can tell by his facial expressions. Yep. All right.
All right, sir. Mike, go ahead and open your eyes.
Okay.
And read the black card again, and then read a set of cards.
For my next trick, I will pull blank out of blank.
You will pull
sharks with legs
out of
a bucket of fish heads.
That was pretty horrible.
Yeah, that was pretty bad.
Yeah.
All right, next. Next set.
For my next trick, I will pull almost giving money to a homeless person out of licking things to claim them as your own.
They're both funny.
That was better.
That was much better.
For my next trick, I will pull the boners of the elderly out of a sassy black woman. Yeah, baby.
Would that be the response?
That would be my response.
All right, I'll take that black card, sir. That's mine. That's the one I gave you.
Jeff, you should be happy with yours. I'll take those.
Yeah, that one's not bad.
That one was last weekend. It really was.
All right, my card is... What's that smell? It might go along with what happened last weekend. What's that smell? All right. You guys pick your responses and then toss them my way. Are we good?
Just one.
Right. Just one, buddy.
Oh, just one? What? One, oh, yeah. Yep, just one.
Just one card.
Yeah. Yeah, only if it has two blanks.
Oh.
Yep. So are we good now?
Hold on. Hold your horses.
Oh. Okay. All right. And now we're good. All right.
Now we're good.
They're over there. Sorry.
It's okay. What is that smell? Genghis Khan.
Ew.
Is it from the movie? No, the movie is what's the
it was John Wayne.
The worst Genghis Khan of all time.
Chinky Chonga.
Yeah. He played Genghis Khan. It was horrible.
Did he really? Oh, yeah. I didn't know that.
He had eyeshadow and some tape pulling his eyes back.
It's so terrible.
He'd be going, they're looking, you know, he'd start talking.
That was actually a very good John Wayne, by the way. What's that smell? Sexual peeing. Oh. What's that smell? Sorry. Literally eating shit. I'm going to go with the literally eating shit. Yeah, who gave me that one? Jeff.
That was mine. That was a good one.
God bless you, sir. There you go.
That was awesome.
That was a fantastic one. All right. What's Teach for America using to inspire any inner city students to succeed? What's Teach for America using to inspire inner city students to succeed?
All right. Eyes are closed. Mike was deliberating. All right. You're good. You're good, Jeff. Go ahead.
All right. What's Teach for America using to inspire inner city students to succeed? Seeing things from Hitler's perspective. What's Teach for America using to inspire inner city students to succeed? Another shot of morphine.
Rough.
What's Teach for America using to inspire inner city students to succeed? Ronald Reagan. I got to go with saying thing from Hitler's perspective.
Yeah, I like that one.
Oh, man, that was funny. That was good. Good win.
I see a theme happening here. Yeah.
Just hanging on the white card?
Yeah, I'll take him. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a twofer. Lucky because you have two cards left. This could be horrible. It could be great. Honey, I have a new... Oh, yeah. Who has three?
He's got three because he had the twofer. He had his own twofer, so he's...
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
No, not really. He's the guest. That's why he gets...
Oh, she gets an extra one.
Honey, I have a new role play I want to try tonight. You can be blank, and I'll be blank.
All right.
You want me to dish out some new cards?
No.
It's going to be pretty rough? Or?
No, I think we should just go with it. It's like Russian roulette.
All right. I totally agree. Just like Russian roulette.
Just like Russian roulette. All right. Go for it. Right. Yep. Let's see.
Honey, I have a new role play I want to try tonight. You can be a sex comet from Neptune that plunges to Earth into eternal sexiness, and I'll be the hustle. I like that one.
I've never heard that card before.
Honey, I have a new role play I want to try tonight. You can be the World of Warcraft, and I'll be mutually assured destruction. Oh, I like that one. That's a good one. I like that one a lot.
Now you fucked up the order.
Shut up. Honey, I have a new role play I want to try tonight. You can be science, and I'll be the day the birds attacked. I'm going to go with World of Warcraft.
Who's the winner? Mike, you came out ahead of everybody. Good job, you.
I'll take all yours.
Cards Against Humanity. If you like it, go to cardsagainsthumanity.com.
I like that game.
You can download it for free, Mike.
Really?
You can go on their website. You can download it for free. You just had to print it off on your printer. Or you can buy it for $25.
I'd rather go $25.
Yes.
Exactly. How long it take you to print all those cards? Yeah. Cut them all out.
We need card stock. Mix it up with Valentine's Day cards.
And they do have holiday packs.
Yes, they do.
They have Christmas. They have, it's fantastic.
Right now they have five expansion packs, which I have them all. And I also have the bigger, blacker box that you see on the TV up there. It's 21 inches long and 17 ounces of pain and pleasure.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
We played it for probably 4 hours on New Year's Eve, I think.
Oh, really? It was wonderful. Incredible. Everybody was crying, laughing. And,
my stomach hurt next day. It was fantastic.
Extremely fun. And if you buy a pack of Cards Against Humanity, they will donate to a charity in your area.
Oh, that's good.
Not just who they like, but who's in your area. So that's pretty cool. Cards Against Humanity.
Well, and you email somebody and you say, hey, we want to play your game on the air. Would you be okay with that? It's open source. Do whatever the hell you want with it. And I was like, oh, fantastic. Yeah.
It can only help them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. You know how I looked you up today? And by the way, I didn't find like your own website. Do you have your own website? You know
what? Somebody kept bugging it, and I went, heck with it.
Because
I do a thing about Satan, and then somebody,
what?
Some guy named Jesus came after me, and he was bugging it, and then a couple
Are you serious?
No, like, I'm serious. Shit
for it?
God, it's so
and
dumb.
And it's not even bad. Matter of fact, I sell T-shirts.
What's the T-shirt say?
Holy water burns, it burns, it burns.
Because I clicked on this link.
I would wear that T-shirt. That's awesome. Oh, man.
I clicked on that link that says go to my page, and this pulled up.
Baseball player.
And I thought, what the fuck? Man, Mike, you're really into a lot of different things.
No.
But that's not, that wasn't
He's
you.
He's a good guy. Me and him has actually talked.
You got a MySpace page, though. That's good.
Yeah, that means you're current. That means you're up to date.
It
means
you're around the originals. I don't even know who did that because I didn't do it. I'm not very good at that. I do Facebook.
Hey, you friended me. I friended you, and you approved my request, so I really appreciate that.
Oh, man, I'm behind.
Yeah, I'll pull up Facebook so you can check out Mike's Facebook
page. You know, and I don't ever put anything negative down on Facebook. I try to stay positive about everything. You know?
Sure.
That's I mean, it's just like me and my sister was talking. I go, on this road trip, it was supposed to snow everywhere. And I said, well, it's just going to snow on the days I'm off where I'm in hotels. And that's exactly what's happened the whole 9 days.
Nice. Did you read The Secret? Is that why it's working so well?
No,
did you read
you
The Secret?
You know what? I just...
you manifested your thoughts.
You manifested your own destiny.
You put it out there to the universe.
I just don't ever get negative.
That's good.
You know, whatever happened, my dad always said, if it doesn't matter in 3 years, it doesn't matter. And I've always lived by that, and the kids have lived by that. Even when their mom left, I pulled them all in that night, and I said, now, is it really going to matter in 3 years that your mom's gone? And they went, no. And I said, there you go. Let's get over it right now.
So they haven't had she hasn't had contact with them?
They finally had contact with her lately, but it's been like 5 years. And wow. I told them they needed to get over it, you know.
So they're not holding any grudges or anything? That's tough.
You know, it's not worth it.
Too much energy, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
and I go, you know, she's not a bad person. She just made bad choices, you right. know. So
that's a great perspective to have.
I'd still kill her if I had it.
No. I was waiting for something. No. By the off chance that happens, Mike had nothing to do with it.
She gave me a lot of material. I always said I'd kill her, but she talked through the whole thing and ruined it for me. You know? I could be stabbing her. She'd be going, that better not be one of my good knives. I just had this carpet cleaned. That's the way women are, though.
Oh, that's great.
That's my two other boys right there.
Right here, the dogs.
Yeah, got them the same day. One's a Chow German Shepherd, and the other one's Chihuahua. Chihuahua's Rufus, and the Chow is Humphrey.
Humphrey?
That's my granddaughter.
How many grandkids do you have?
Two.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Do you like being a grandfather?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I got into it with one of their mothers last night because she's like, you need to quit spending so much money on her. I go, I'm not married to you. Shut up.
It's your granddaughter. You can do whatever the hell you want.
Grandfathers trump moms, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Grandparents goes, always every time, trump moms.
That's always been the saying. That's yeah. always been the well, saying. When I'm a grandparent, I get to spoil you rotten.
Yeah.
That's what grandparents get to do.
And exactly. If I say I'm taking them to the zoo and then we end up at the racetrack.
And I'm teaching her about math
yeah.
and statistics and yeah, odds.
There you go.
You got to look at it on the. You got to spin it. You got to look at the silver lining.
It's this new math.
My ex-wife
awesome.
Thought we went to California and we made a pit stop in Vegas and stayed there. They played their first slot machines when they were like 11, 12, 13.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because I was a cop and I said, hey, man, you know, my sons need to play. So then my ex-wife found a picture of my one son that was about 15 holding a beer with two black chicks with their arms playing a slot.
Oh, that's awesome.
You got to teach them.
Yeah.
Now, decent segue. Thank you for bringing in the Vegas thing. One of the guys that I do work with, ex-cop, and he was telling me he just recently had to go to Vegas for a firearms instructor class. Mm-hmm. And he was able to take down a 50 cal rifle. Really? And so when he was down there, he's with all these...
50 cal rifle.
Rifle? What, he owns it?
It was a precision... The class was precision marksmanship. So okay. He was able to take... He took down a 50 cal.
Of his own? It's his own gun or no?
No.
Oh, okay.
We don't have to get into that. But
it's kind of like 50 caliber right guns now, are a big
thing. None of us have guns on us. Yeah.
I don't. I'm too much of a pussy to hold a gun.
But
really?
Yeah. Yeah. Guns make him nervous.
They do.
Really? I'm getting better.
I'm thinking about starting hunting and things like that. I'm trying to get better about it.
I don't hunt. I can shoot a human in a heartbeat. I've never heard
I'm the opposite.
Oh, it hurts. Take me to the hospital.
I love your bit about finding the guy in the closet.
That's a true story.
Oh, God, that's funny.
That scared the crap out of me, too, man.
Dude, it's...
I popped a cap and ran at the same time.
Being a cop going room to room, it's like playing hide-and-go-seek. And that scares the horrible shit out of me when I'm playing with my kids, and I'm like, open up a closet door, and they're right there.
Me and my partner was playing like... We just decided we wanted to be like Adam 12 for this call. So we just started acting like, you know, at 12:45 where we entered the, you know, we're doing all that crap. She's really impressed.
She doesn't know anything.
We're showing flat and we're rolling across the floor coming up, Claire, you know, just goofing. And he opened up that closet and I got ready to yell clear and there was a guy just holding a pistol. I went, bam, took off running.
Well, he's holding the gun.
Well, I shot his trigger finger off and it landed on my pocket.
Are you shitting me?
Yeah, and so cops don't let nothing go. So everybody's like, hey, well, Bill, why don't you teach us those tricks and all that kind of stuff.
Oddly enough, that happens quite often because when I have to requalify and we're walking and doing the go, no-go targets, and they have targets where they're holding the polymer gun, you know, the fake gun. Every time we do training, somebody shoots that gun.
You feel like you almost shoot at the gun that you think is going to shoot you.
Yeah, you instinctively. Yeah. I mean, you're shooting really. I mean, as soon as you identify the target and you're like, that's the bad guy. You're pulling the trigger. Not even, you know, I'm not taking careful aim at the gun, but I've shot that gun out of the guy's hand. I don't know how many times.
Really,
out of the dummy's hand. Like, it just obliterates the gun. Because you instinctively do that.
You just want to stop that gun. You're not worried about him.
Interesting. Yeah.
So when he said he shot his fucking finger off, now the part where it lands in your pocket, that was like, wow.
That was freaky. Made me almost throw up. And then
somebody get it.
Yeah, and that's what I did.
Have you seen the commercial where if you've been online all day, your fingers fall off and blah, 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 you see
my little sister went off about that. That should not be on TV. And I'm like, really?
What, shooting the finger off?
No. You haven't seen that commercial?
No.
The guy is on the shot is this way. So a guy is at the computer and you're looking at him and something about if you've been on the computer all day long that your fingers would fall off. All of a sudden,
his fingers fly.
Fingers go. And they're just like laying there on the side. He's like, ah, damn it.
And then at the end, he gives thumbs up.
That's funny.
Yeah.
That's good.
God, people are so oversensitive. Holy cow.
Now, if a finger fell in my pocket then I saw that commercial, maybe I'd have a little PTSD.
No, you know what? I quit doing that bit because when I do theater shows on the Bob and Tom tours, people would pay homage and bring up fake fingers. I had buckets of them. And I thought, Jesus, I got to quit this because one day there's going to be a real one, you know?
Oh, damn.
And I don't want that. There's so many nuts, they go, watch this, I'm going to cut my finger off and give it to
them. A bucket of fake fingers, that's so great.
Can you even imagine that one day that would have to be a fear of yours? I can't say this bit because they might bring up a bucket of pierced vaginas.
Right.
Yeah, you got to make it good. Like, you got to make a really awesome bit and where they just bring up boobs after boobs.
That's usually after the show.
Oh, okay. That happens anyway.
Those aren't fake. Well, it could be fake.
You know, and I'm old, and I know what I look like, you know? And these hot chicks come up to me. You know, I don't care if they got father issues or whatever. I'm hitting.
God bless America, man.
Yeah, I love honesty.
That's why we started this podcast. If you're pissed off and people are not getting pissed off about every little thing somebody Chopin says. There.
Danny Chopin-y.
You know, there's nothing wrong with it.
I mean, it's just funny.
You know what? I was faithful for 32 years, and I've been divorced for 5. And my sons counted up that I've had over 120 women
since in the past five years.
Well, in the last 2 weeks, I've probably had 5.
What's your secret?
I don't
Match.
Know.
Match.com.
No, I don't lie about anything. I tell them, if you can get past everything about me, I'm a great catch, you know? But right. Besides that.
Well, women say, like, confidence and a sense of humor are two of the bigger things. So yeah, you got both of those.
Yeah, and I could care less. And they know I could care less. I go, hey, I'm leaving. See you. Boom. You know? When I was in Vegas, I was fooling around this girl that looked just like, she's from Iowa, too. And
sweet.
She looked like Kim Kardashian. And
before or after the butt implants?
Both.
Butt implants.
Oh, yeah. I just called her Iowa. She called me Kentucky. We messed around for 3 days. And actually, I was doing a corporate show, and the woman called the agency, and she said, I thought he was very funny, but his moral standings were terrible. She goes, he introduced me to this girl, and I know they were having sex. And he didn't even know her name and could have cared less. And I go, I don't care about that kind of stuff.
Her name was Iowa.
That actually could be like a 5-star rating. If I'm looking for a good comedian, do they have moral standing?
No. That's what I want.
That's what he tried to tell her. He goes, it doesn't matter what he was doing. She goes, well, he encouraged other people to do it too. And I'm like, you're in Vegas, for God's sake.
Now, I just realized this. I had thought for many years that prostitution was legal in Vegas.
No, she wasn't a prostitute.
Oh, no, I'm not saying you. I'm not saying that she was.
It's not legal in Vegas.
But it's not. I just learned that today.
It's on the outskirts of Vegas.
What's the bunny ranches?
Is there a county? I thought the state of Nevada was.
No, there's a county.
Yeah, it's outside of Vegas. Yeah.
Right, but I can't think of the name of the county, though, that it's in. Anyway, same guy who was telling me about the precision firearm instructor class, he said all these cops, the one thing was all the different stories, everything, there was a common theme. One was, those aren't my pants. I don't know where that came from, but those aren't my pants. That was a common theme because every cop, I don't know if you've ever heard that. I don't know where that came from. Those aren't my drugs. These aren't even my pants. So that was a common theme. And then the other thing was...
one more get in the house, you're going to jail.
What's that?
You always tell them, you got one more chance to go in the house or you're going to jail. You can't tell me what to do on my property. And then all of a sudden, you got to cuff them up. You know, they're going to jail. Then all of a sudden, okay, I'll go in the house. Too late.
Too late. Now, yeah, we told you.
Yeah.
But he was saying that... one cop was saying... there's a lot of police officers that go to Vegas for these firearms instructions, and they have the wrong idea that prostitution is legal.
It's everywhere, though.
So then they come back, and whether they got busted for it or whatever, a lot of guys lose their jobs.
Oh, shit.
A lot of police officers lose their jobs, and one police officer said, yeah, I was getting ready to get on the elevator. The elevator doors were closing, and I witnessed a lawyer hit the guy next to him, and he said, I told you, if they're hot, they're a cop. If they're hot, they're a cop. I was like, oh, I'll have to keep that in mind maybe.
That's right.
Someday.
Someday we go to Vegas.
Usually if they're chunky, they're cops.
They're chunky, they're funky, man.
Oh,
I'm
with
you on that.
If they're chunky, they're cops.
Yeah. You don't see that many hot cop women anymore because they all... kind of like chunky.
Do you think that's because they're trying, they feel like they have to
bulk up
and put that weight on, right?
Yeah, and be more manly to get more respect,
to have that presence.
Yeah,
right.
I guess when they go to Vegas, when they have that porn Oscars or whatever, that porn show. Yeah.
The AVN Awards.
I heard
Jeff.
Good job. I know too much about that.
Jeff is all over it.
Actually, like I've been out there for three conferences and they were going on at the same time. It's ridiculous.
I've heard stories, and not that I want to hook up with a porn star necessarily, but
that means he does.
Hold on a second. Would you?
I'm
married though.
I'm married. Yeah,
one,
I wouldn't. But you hear stories of guys who are out there for conferences and they just bump into women at like the bar and they're porn stars. Like they're just everywhere because they're out there for the conference.
Yeah, it's crazy.
But see, everybody goes out there knowing you're going to get in trouble. That's the only time I ever I got a female attorney. I call her every time I go to Vegas. And I go, I'm going to Vegas. And she goes, okay, I'll leave my cell phone by my bed. You know, because I know I'm going to get in trouble.
Really?
That's the only time I drink. Oh. I don't drink any other time. But when I'm in Vegas, I'm loaded to the gill. And the last time I was there, my son said, you ought to make a movie out of it. It could be like Hangover 4. I mean, because I actually woke up in another hotel. I had no idea where I was at.
So when you do drink, it could be blackout drunk.
It's disturbing drunk. I don't care what I do. It's come back a couple of times. I was doing a show in Lexington, and this girl came up to me, and she goes, remember me? And I said, no. She said, well, I was in Vegas when you was there, and I had a Kentucky shirt on. And you said, come here. She said, you licked my face and yelled, there ain't nothing tastes better than a Kentucky woman or whiskey. And I went, be gone.
I licked my face.
And you got away with it. And you got away with it.
That's what I do when I'm drinking. That's why I don't like to do that kind of stuff
too often. But when you go to Vegas.
Well, me and Iowa, we won like probably $8,000. And we were drunk. And I said, what have you always wanted to do that you were always afraid of? She goes, go to a high-end strip club. So really? I got a driver, and we went to a high-end strip club. I had like four chicks on her, all races, just all over. I was like, oh, yeah, this is hot. So her buddy's with us, you know, whatever she is. So on the way back, she goes, I want to get married. And I go, no way. That ain't happening.
Oh, God. That's possibly the scariest fucking thing to hear in Vegas.
Well, she said, well, I always wanted to get married at the Eiffel Tower. So I said, pull over, driver. So this homeless guy was there, and I said, I'll give you $50 and marry us. So he said, okay. And since y'all cussing, I'll go ahead. So these two cops are walking down the street, and I go, hey, man, come here. I need a best man. So this cop stands in. Some woman hands her flyers. This homeless guy's up on the step. He goes, you, Iowa, take Kentucky. And you, Kentucky, take Iowa. And I said, sure. And he goes, you may now fuck the bride. And so we go to this hotel, and I'm thinking we're at Caesar's. So we wake up the next morning or the next afternoon. And this Asian woman goes, you can't stay here anymore. And I go, where are we? She goes, you at Bally's. I go, well, how far away is Caesar's? She goes, I'll never forget. She goes, you are so close.
Missed it by that much.
So I'm talking to my son because I'd gotten in some more trouble that night. And he goes, man, that sounds like a perfect Hangover 3. And
yeah.
I can't hardly hear him, so I walk out the door. You know, it's nice air conditioner. I go walk out the door. It's like 150 degrees. Mm-hmm. And I started going, bleh.
Oh, God.
And my son goes, call me later. He's in Afghanistan.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
That's a unique and cool relationship that you have with him.
My kids, we're all best friends. I can honestly say we are all best friends. Every one of them call me every day at least once and text me twice a day. Always have. They're worried about me. You know,
it sounds like they have.
Well, they have a reason to. You haven't been to Vegas lately, have you?
Yeah. My daughters are always going, did you get laid this weekend? And I'm like, you know, and I've gotten used to it. First couple of times, it shocked me.
Yeah.
But they hate their mother so bad. They like, go out there and, you know, you did everything for mom and she did this to you, treated you like a dog all those years. We want you to hit everything you can.
I hope my daughter never asks me that. I totally agree.
I can't imagine my daughter saying to me, so dad, did you hit that this weekend? What do you mean, did I hit that?
Well,
did
you know, balls deep. She's seen a picture of me and this girl from South Dakota. And that's my daughter texts me, "You're going to hit that, right?"
That's
and I go,
fantastic.
"I'm trying." Quit texting me, you know.
If you'd shut the fuck up, I might have a chance. Was, yeah.
It doesn't help when I'm checking my phone every 5 minutes. Ding, ding. Not yet.
Ding, ding. Oh, I just have that kind of relationship with my kid, even my priest son. He's like, "Hey, kill it."
One son's a priest.
Yeah, well, he's on the final stages of being a priest. He's got a parish.
A Catholic priest?
Really?
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. And he's like, hit whatever you can, man. He's like all for it.
This could he'll just go down a completely different avenue.
We had no time to discover this individual together. Because I started getting a grasp of him when we first sat down.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this is going to be pretty unique and pretty awesome.
Because I laugh you, all the time, but I can't you, help it. That's me.
Because
that's
you,
cool.
I mean,
I like it.
I like people who are a unique individual. That's the best part.
All right. So how does this work? Jeff, I mean, it's really none of my business. But what are you a particularly religious fella?
Yeah.
Subscribe heavily to one
yeah
particular thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
I go to church every Sunday
okay
with my kids.
Very good.
Yeah.
And your son is a Catholic priest. He's not got, like Methodist. He's not no, like
he's got red
back
hair and he's kind of overweight. He's got a black parish.
What
and
do
they
you,
love
what
him.
You, why what really set him down that path? What do you think really motivated
him? You know,
him?
I always knew. He never was real religious, but I always knew he'd be a priest. Isn't that weird?
Well, he just has a like calming nature about him.
He is. He's one of these guys, if you ever meet him, you want to hug him.
Really?
He's one of those guys you want to hug.
Likeable.
And he's just kind. And oh. He's got the... He cusses so much. He's already said the F-bomb, you know, while he was doing a sermon.
Really? Goes, giving a sermon.
He goes, "Why in the fuck did I say that?" He goes, "Get used to it." That's the way
well,
he is.
I've always said things that when it would be nice to know that, like, Jesus was a normal guy that
yeah.
walked around and had normal things. So I would think it'd be kind of refreshing to have a priest who was much more like a person like you
that
are.
That you can completely well, you know, relate
yeah,
to.
And realize that we all make mistakes and we're all kind of like that.
His parish had like 50, 60 people. Now it's up to like 7-something within a year. Because he just, they all want to touch him, you know. I mean, he walked in and he goes, "You're probably wondering what a redheaded white boy is doing at all black church." And he goes, "Because you black girls know how to party."
and the church is down in Louisville?
Yeah.
Right?
And
okay.
We're at a luncheon. This is, I mean, it's just continuously. And this old dude walks up and he goes, "Father Christopher, I'd like to do confession." Christopher went like this, put his hand on his son and said, "Hurry up, I know who you are. It doesn't matter." And that's the way he is.
I would see that guy. I would actually go to church if that was my minister, if that was my priest.
Yeah.
And it was that type of relationship. Like you and I, we started going to a church years ago, primarily because the guy that was running the church had that wonderful type of personality.
Right, exactly.
And then shortly thereafter, he left.
Yeah.
And then they always do. They
yeah, the good ones always.
Offers. I mean, bigger churches. You can't blame them.
How does that work exactly? I mean, is it like you're a free agent? Like, hey, that guy over there in Cedar Rapids, boy, he's really pulling in the money. He's doing a great job. We need to pull him over here.
Well, you know, they'll say, okay, you brought this parish up. Let's take you over to this other one's having problems, you know. Yeah.
Well, the Catholic
in Mississippi or wherever
Catholic Church, they have like a hierarchy, so it's like they got like you know certain sects of the you know Midwest, and then they all know who's all you know they get appointed and they get moved up. But like churches that aren't affiliated, that's a different thing. It's kind of it's kind of like newscasters, I think. You know, like an anchor that you look at him and go, "Oh, we like that guy. Let's go try to recruit him."
Yeah,
I think that's how it works.
Are you Catholic, Jeff?
No.
Because it kind of sounds like Amway. Like you're an emerald now.
Work that's up to be a double diamond.
Exactly what it is.
It's Amway. The one going to heaven.
Religious Amway.
Religious Amway. Hey, you're going to pray anyway. This way, we all benefit. Just come here.
I always tease everybody, "Well, you're not going to Catholic heaven, that's for sure."
You may go to some form of heaven, but not Catholic heaven.
I see. My one daughter-in-law is real super. Both of my daughter-in-laws are Mexicans. So they're very
religious. Your granddaughters are gorgeous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so she asked me why not. She goes, hey, Grandpa, do poor people go to heaven? I go, yes, but they just don't get to live in the good part. My daughter-in-law was like, quit telling her that crap. You know
what? But kids being around that type of influence, you know, my wife, the first time I went and met her extended family, her nieces and nephews, I thought, they are solid. These kids are going to be able to go into high school, college, and the worst bully at the school could come up and fuck with them, as give them the best that he's got, and they're going to be like, dude, you got nothing on my Aunt Kathy. You know? But that's kind of cool that if you can constructively funny, in a way, jab a kid so that they can learn how to have good, funny feedback. Like, I think I did. I didn't articulate it well enough when I said we put too much emphasis on getting rid of all bullies, the whole bullying thing. I brought that up in a previous podcast. And I think what I mean is if kids have to learn how to deal with life situations.
Right.
Life in general is not bubble wrapped. So we can't bubble wrap our kids. And kids have to take in small doses those types of situations to learn how to deal with them.
Well, otherwise, we're raising victims. We're not raising people that defend themselves. We're raising victims.
Right.
Because, you know, all that, oh, don't play on the schoolyard, you're going to get hurt. Or, if he says this to you, then you turn away, you be the bigger person. Knock his head off, and he ain't never going to say nothing. I mean, I'm a little guy, but maybe it's just the way I was brought up. I had 8 brothers and sisters, and my dad said, anybody touch you, you try to kill them. You know, bottom line.
Well, I think part of it is you learn to handle yourself whatever way it is. I think walking away may be an option, but I think it's better to – I told my son, I said, when he didn't get bullied but he was concerned about something, I was like, does it even matter? Yeah. It doesn't even – who cares what they say? Who cares what they think? Yeah, what words, do you think?
Words are okay, but when they touch you, then you take care of business. You know?
My daughter came home from school the other day and she goes, Dad, I have to work out. She's in 5th grade. I'm fat. I'm like, what? Oh, boy. She's really sad. She was really sad about it. And I go, why are you so upset? What happened today that made you so weirded out and want to work out? And she said, well, there's a boy that walked by and said, get out of my way, fatty. And that really struck her. And I thought, you know, if you know how to handle that situation verbally – then you're not scarred. You're not thinking about it all night long. And I said, honey, do you know how often I get teased? I go, I get teased all the time at work. I tease people. I have a lot of friends. I tease people and they tease me. And I have to know that I've teased that person too much. And it's time for me to take my ass kicking for a while so that they can feel good about themselves, you know, that they can walk out and go, man, I got Matt. Well, he feels pretty stupid right now. But that's okay. That's a relationship. But if kids – I think sometimes kids look at their parents and go, you know what? When I get older, that won't ever happen to me again. I don't really have to deal with it now because hopefully when I get older, I won't be teased. But that's that relationship. In the military, guys jab each other and they create this brotherhood, that bond. And a lot of it comes from that teasing, that jabbing back and forth and knowing how to handle it and how to dish it out and when not to dish it out and when to take it. So, yeah, I tried to explain that to a 5th grader. I don't think she necessarily got it, but I said, if you want to work out and you feel like you've gained too much weight, I'll help you in any way I can. So she's going to be doing this girl power run thing.
I hate to hear that kind of stuff. I really do. It bothers me. You know, but I mean, I've always been teased about being short, but I could care less. Yeah.
Well, I've only seen you
standing up.
I've only seen
you standing the whole time.
Now, if your feet are just kicking, I don't know.
My toes are touching.
I saw your video and I go, I think he's not that tall.
Well, you know what? People come up and they'll go, I thought you were taller. And I go, it's a headshot. What can you judge how tall I am by a headshot?
What exactly gave you perspective to think that I'm 6'4"?
How tall are you?
I'm 5'6".
Well, that's not
crazy.
I will say this, sir. You are put together well.
When I was younger. I'm 63 now.
But you're in great shape. I know a lot of 63-year-olds that look like they should be in the ground already.
I just don't act 63. I'm not sitting in a lazy boy at home, you know.
Doing nothing. You're moving around.
I'm always doing something.
You work out?
No. Hell no.
You don't know Pilates?
I go to the bathroom. I run to the bathroom every once in a while.
Get there and then like, oh, God, yeah, please, prostate, just let it go.
No, I don't have any of those problems.
No issues.
Guys, you know.
We're talking about erectile dysfunction before you got here.
Where the fuck did that come from?
You said issues. You don't have
any. Yeah, I know, but in the time that you started and I showed up, where exactly did erectile dysfunction?
It ran all over the place. Yeah. Well, you talked about erectile dysfunction before we were recording.
And I said a good breeze gets me going.
Yeah, you said a good breeze gets me going.
I don't need that little blue pill.
I really don't.
I have great circulation down there. Thank you.
You know what? I know guys in their 30s that can't do nothing, and they have to take it. And I'm like, really? What? That's psychological.
I think you're right. I think a lot of it is psychological.
Yeah. Hoping you're afraid you won't be able to.
Well, I know I have just because I want to last longer. Simply that.
You know what's funny?
It's nothing.
Care that much?
You know what?
That's a good question. That might be part of the problem.
I care a little too much.
That might be part of the problem. I actually said the other day that I said, you know what? I'm not anti-woman, but I've gotten to a point recently when there seems to be an overwhelming theme. Like, my wife is on Facebook a lot. A lot.
They're like, they're just post-it notes, man.
Yeah.
Just always got something to say.
And my wife had posted the other day, hey, my husband called me from work. He made my day. He said he, you know, supports me, whatever. I did something nice. I'm going to have to reward him. I'm going to shave my legs. Every fucking comment after that was about her rewarding me and her shaved legs, and you go, girl, and get another fucking razor, and don't shave your legs, girl power. Nothing about how great a guy I am. All about, hey, good job rewarding your man with sex. That is probably the most demasculating thing there is.
That should be just...
Exactly. Exactly. It should never be looked at as a reward.
That when I was married, me and my wife probably did it 6-7 times a week for 32 years.
You sound a lot like my father, sir.
And we do freaky stuff, too, you know?
That a boy.
Yeah. I'm that still that way. She's just not there. It's just like,
you know what? Feel free. Go and share. Whatever you like.
Well, okay. I'm in.
I actually got to I have to go. I'm not, like, offended by what you're saying. I got
That's it.
I got to go. I'm out of here. I didn't know Mike was this way. You're done. Your corporate's canceled for tomorrow. You have no moral standards.
No moral standards.
I'm calling the corporate you're doing Saturday night.
Yeah, I'm doing a corporate for him Saturday night. San Diego, South Dakota. I was doing corporate for him. Here I am going, hey, I nailed this half-black chick, man. He's going to want me to pay him from now. Yeah.
Where are you going? Where are you heading?
I'm going to Bethlehem, Pennsylvania on Friday, and then I'm going to Red Bank, New Jersey on Saturday, Sunday with the Jokers, Practical Jokers.
Oh, cool.
Anything else you want to plug real quick? Now, this podcast will be out a week from this Monday.
I used to have the squeaky clean reputation of like, oh, he goes straight to his hotel room because he's married. Now I got a little bit of a reputation like he's hitting this, hitting that.
Well, don't. Yeah, self-promotion.
If you book him in Vegas, sorry. Make sure his attorney's on retainer.
Right. Make sure the show's early in the week. Exactly. Yeah, no, that's we got Michael Winslow coming into the club. The guy from Police Academy does all the sound effects. He's coming in the end of February.
Mm-hmm.
And then lots of Bob and Tom people. We got Greg Warren coming in. We got Andy Kindler from Letterman.
Cool.
Kindler's brilliant, like brilliant, smart. We got the Untamed Shrews, which is filthy, dirty female comics.
Sweet.
So we got a lot of good stuff coming in. So
well, great. I'll keep putting your penguins on there.
Yeah,
I'll keep putting USA Entertainment on there.
Perfect. And Mike's can stay and entertain you.
You going to hang out with us for a little bit longer? Is that all right?
I'm having a good time, actually.
Good. I'm glad.
Stay as long as you like.
And he's going to be on the, not that this is going to matter, but he's going to be on TV tomorrow morning on Fox.
Really?
It's, yeah, I know that.
I was going to be there. Yeah, my dad's picking Fox affiliate.
Yeah, so he's on a Fox morning news at 7:30 tomorrow. So.
Oh, cool.
That's cool.
Attaboy. Yeah. All right. Nothing makes you nervous anymore, does it?
Nah, I could care less. You know, I mean, I have a good time when I'm there. You know, if it goes south, it goes south. And I just, it never does, but.
My mom and dad were together for 35 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've been divorced for about probably 10 years now. And I am proud of my mom to go out there and get on different websites and meet somebody for lunch and just meet people. Just get out there and live life.
What happens, though, you know? I mean, it's just like my divorce happened in one day. I mean, it just happened in one day.
Done.
And I'd never seen it coming, and she says she didn't see it coming.
Really?
Yeah, and we just, it was over in one day. And the kids packed their stuff up, put it in the driveway, and said, see you later.
Now, see, I've been married before, and that it kind of happened, boom, in one day. There's like a revelation or something that happened. Mm-hmm. I love going to movies. That's my thing. My mom took me to movies when I was a little kid. Mm-hmm. Very special atmosphere for me. Right. I could go by myself. I love movie theaters. Love the whole thing. But my first wife, I had felt like not a priority in her life.
That's
she was very, very business oriented. My first wife.
So was my wife.
And one day she came home and she goes, "Hey, honey, let's go to the so and so whatever movie. I forget what movie it was. Let's go to this movie." And I snapped. The one thing that I loved doing had, when she said it, it was just this nasty, ugly thing. I said, "You know, I'm gonna go move in with my folks," just out of nowhere. "No, I'm gonna go move in with my folks because this is fucked up for some whatever reason. You shouldn't say let's go see a movie and me have this reaction. I gotta move out."
See, my ex-wife thought she was better than everybody else. And that's because I was making so much money at the time that we bought the big house. Our house was like 5,500 square feet.
And this was when you were a police officer?
No, this is when I started doing comedy.
Oh, you did? All right.
I just got a lot of breaks, you know, and I started being on TV shows, you know, Comedy Central, CMT, HBO. I'm doing all these shows, and I'm on Bob and Tom all the time. I'm making a killing. And all of a sudden, I'm buying her all this stuff, and all of a sudden, she dropped all of our old friends, made these new yuppie friends, and it just, I'd come home, and they'd all be sitting there, you know, drinking wine and eating fruit, and, you know, and they'd be talking all yuppie, and I'm like a country kind of guy, and they'd go, "Oh, isn't this fun food?" And I go, "You know, it's fruit. You know, get out of my house." And they go, "Oh, you're a ruffian." You know?
Really?
Oh, yeah. They go, "He's a ruffian." You know, I go, "Who do you think buys this crap? You know, who do you think's paying for all this?"
Sure.
And then she'd go, "Why do you have to be a redneck?" I go, "Because if I ever change, we lose all of this. This is
great
what people
point.
Pay to see. They pay to see the real me. And I am a redneck.
And you're not going to change for anybody else.
I can't do it." I would tease her because she'd go, "Oh, I'll go." And I go, "Right after I get done with the war," you know. Well, she didn't even know. When we moved in this house, we had a housekeeper. She did not. And I'm home like 5 days a week. So I did all the laundry and the house cleaning. And my son, he cooks, or I'd cook. She never did nothing. She went to work.
So did you ask? So why did you get the housekeeper?
Just to help me out. Because the house was like three floors, and we had two kitchens.
Please tell me she was hot. Was she really hot?
The housekeeper? No, she was. She couldn't even speak English.
That doesn't matter. Sometimes that's really hot.
"Hey, you want a banana up your butt?" And she'd go, "No." My son could walk in.
He's like,
"Hey,
the uncle." He's like the uncle I never had.
And see, and here's the funny part.
She did speak English.
My son could walk by and go, "How about a lap dance?"
We were always saying the same.
Now, stuff. That is therapeutic. Isn't that a little bit? I mean, mm-hmm. Can you imagine walking by? Again, what you said earlier, the reason why we started the podcast is because we hate political correctness. We hate having to shove it all down. I go to work, and I got to be super careful of who I say something to.
That's why I like this job, because I go to different – I mean, when I was in South Dakota and I was cutting through, I went to the Spam Museum. I went to where Buddy Holly crashed. And, I went to Field of Dreams. And when I'm in the South, I go to every Civil War site there is.
That's awesome. So well, I was in Atlanta. When we were in Atlanta, we went to the Martin Luther King Museum. That was incredible.
Yeah, that was like
I didn't even know there was 99. One. So that was
A slave museum in Iowa of all places.
Really?
Yeah.
Where at?
I can't remember where it's at, but look it up.
Well, they actually have a African American museum.
Slave museum Checktown. Would be awesome, though.
I say black. I can't get that African-American. I can't.
Well, for my...
It's actually named the African-American Museum. That's probably why you're using that.
That's what I'm saying.
And it's called Slave Museum.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, they don't like you joking.
My no boys, all of my kids are biracial. So
cool.
And adopted. My daughter is in fifth grade, so I went with her when she did her field trip to the African American Museum. And then, so my boys, they're 6 months apart, not blood related, but in the same class, same teacher and all that stuff now. And so when it was their turn for their field trip, I went with them. And so this is my second go round. So that, you know, the person giving the instruction and giving the tour, she kind of takes a break for a little bit, and I pull my kids off to the side. I'm like, see this? Look at this. This is why we have face masks on football helmets. Let's read this little thing right here. And they had this story about a Drake football player who was getting just brutalized by the other team, and the referees weren't calling any of the shots. He actually died a few days later.
Oh, man.
And that was before they had... face masks before they even had the one bar. Yeah. He ended up having like a broken jaw and a bunch of other severe injuries. But yeah, he was the driving force behind having a face mask.
So, I'm assuming he was African American as well.
And that's why he got brutalized.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I find, and it's kind of weird, in the South, white guys love black girls.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody thinks nothing about it. But when you go North, if a white guy's with a black girl, everybody kind of stares. I never understood that.
Wow.
Because white guys in the South only date black girls or Mexicans. And I feel the same way. White girls are just too needy. They think they're entitled. And I always make for an example. I had a black girlfriend for a year. I said, I could buy a white girl a purse for $100, a nice purse.
Mm-hmm.
And she go, really? I really wanted the $500 one. And so won't you take this back? And now I got to buy shoes and an outfit to go with this purse.
Right.
And a black chick or a Mexican would go, oh, thank you very much, you know.
I really appreciate it.
They appreciate it. And white girls don't. And that's why I don't date white girls. I haven't for 5 years. They all been Asian, mulatto, or black, or Mexicans.
I feel like you and I have a lot in common.
And I think every white guy likes darker skin. That's just the way
I have a few fantasies. And
you should live them out.
Well, that's kind of the cool thing. I mean, I don't wish.
Is your wife black or white?
My wife is white. But, you know, getting back to the now
it wasn't everybody's, a very good segue.
Everybody's good assuming segue. I'm going to get back to the black chick. No.
Oh, did you have a thing for black chicks at one time?
Just the fact that my buddy Todd here ruined an opportunity for me to fulfill.
It wasn't my fault.
It was a bucket list. It was one of those bucket list moments.
Todd.
No,
he blocked you.
It's so not my fault. Oh, fuck that. I didn't block you.
No. We've brought it up a couple times on the podcast. We've brushed by it a couple times on the podcast.
Is he one of those, hey, you need to call your kids?
But, No, Mike. This was before I was married. I was completely single.
Said it.
And there was a beautiful Nubian goddess. And her name was fucking Perky. Nickname was Perky.
I wonder why.
At his, yeah, exactly. And I would have figured it out. I would have figured out the answer to that mystery. But Todd cock blocked the shit out of me that night.
Oh, no, man.
I'm really tired. I want to go. I'm really tired.
Out really bad. Yeah.
You should. It was very stressful. If I'd been there.
Well, we were in D.C. I've never been to D.C. before. He grew up a little bit in D.C.
Paris, then. Just hope somebody doesn't block you. You lost 2 man points right there.
It was just a perfect. It was one of those times in my life where I had no reason not to.
Yeah,
there was no legitimate reason why I couldn't have lived out one of those.
And
fantasies.
I really think that was my opportunity too to like hook up with those girls that you liked in high school, but you were too much of a geek or whatever to hang out with them or talk to them or.
I had have a great.
If I would have known Mike, I would have called Mike up and said, "Hey, Mike, what did you do last night? I'm fucking doing that tonight." You know what? I might still do that. I might text Mike and say, "What'd you do?"
There should not be an orifice that you have not penetrated.
God bless you.
This guy
I like him. I like him a lot. This guy, saying that right now,
and I demand it.
Just to let you know up ahead of time, just so you know.
And the fact that you're completely honest and forward.
Oh, yeah.
There's guys.
I mean, no bones about it. I tell them, here's what you're going to do. And if you don't like it, adios, baby.
Hey, you're still here. I guess you're open
don't
for it.
Tell me if a girl goes, you know what you should do? They're gone. I'm never going to let that happen again. Don't tell me what I should be doing when your broke ass is sitting there wanting to borrow money from me. You know?
Now, the best sexual advice, we had a sex therapist on. Denise Stapley. She won Survivor Philippines. Do you ever watch Survivor?
No, I don't watch
Survivor. All right. Well, if you did, Mike, she won one of the seasons of Survivor, right? She lives here in Cedar Rapids, and she's a sex therapist. We had her on twice, and one of her pearls of wisdom is basically, I'm paraphrasing, you get yours, and a woman should just, you both should be selfish.
Right.
You do exactly what you want.
Yeah, exactly.
And she does exactly what she wants.
And she's responsible for her own orgasm.
For her own orgasm.
Yeah, for sure.
So for guys to get into that situation and go, oh, God, I hope I perform. I hope I'm big enough. I hope I give her an orgasm.
I told my buddy Danny, and he just got married, and he asked me, I said, your face should be wet from the top of your hair to your chest. I want it that wet. That's how nasty you should be down there.
That's not nasty. I don't think that's nasty.
That's how it should be.
No, aggressive. I don't think it's. But see, most girls think it's nasty if you get too wild.
What's too wild? What's too wild?
I agree with you, brother.
We just talked about whores.
Yeah, I love whores.
On the last podcast, I was saying...
Well, I said Thomas Jefferson was known for being a big proliferator of prostitutes.
Oh.
And so I used the word whore.
I've never been with a prostitute. Okay. I refuse to do that.
Either have I. But Jefferson, or not Jefferson, sorry.
What are you talking about? Paul Revere.
Not Paul Revere. Benjamin Franklin was known for being in France, right. And prostitution was a pretty prevalent thing. And so he was very much into prostitution. And I used the word whore as...
As a reference to prostitution.
Oh. Right.
And
he said
one of the ladies that I work with, she got really upset about the word whore. And I said, listen, women put this horrible emphasis on the word whore. You should be sexually active. A healthy sexual appetite is a good thing.
Yeah.
If you enjoy doing something, do it. And if you're fucking not 10 times out of a week, and you're enjoying it, then do it.
Yeah.
Don't feel guilty, and don't let somebody put a label on you and make you feel guilty about doing something that you love doing.
Right.
Well, see, you know what? Women, they're always all this, we are strong and all that kind of crap. But they hate each other. You never see women get along. They talk about each other. I go, who y'all talk about? The one that walks away. Well, she'd look nice if her shoes matched her outfit. You
know? Right.
And that's the way women are. And they hate forever. I mean, me and you could get in an argument. I see you next time. Hey, man, sorry. Oh, I'm sorry, too. Hug it out. Go on. Women, it's like it lives forever.
Grudge. With them. And the worst example of that is like those shows, those like the Housewives of Orange County or whatever.
Oh, those are the worst. Oh, God. You see, they're just paid prostitutes. They're legal prostitutes. That's exactly. All that is.
When you're selling yourself to give a certain
image. And all that fake boob stuff, you know. I mean, I'm not against them.
Me either.
I mean, if they paid for them, they're theirs. You know?
I really enjoy the fake breasts.
Do you?
Yeah.
I don't see anything wrong with it.
What kind do you like? You like the missile ones?
I like the 2 o'clock. I like the 2 o'clock. The pointing it to the 2 o'clock.
Perkies. I thought
Perkies for sure.
You like the big ones, the big nips, or the little?
I have to if my mouth like is on ones. It and I still and oh, I can yeah. still see areola oh, out of my yeah. peripheral.
That's the best, it's, baby. Especially if they're dark, they can poke your eye out. If you can lose an eye on a boob.
You got an A plus. That's a good. You got an A plus.
That's a good.
Oh yeah. God. Now this show get turned. This went to hell real quick.
Your corporate gigs are gone, Mister.
I can't wait till Jeff hears this. Oh my God.
So what did you guys talk about after I left?
You don't want to know.
Anal. We really talked about anal. We got into that.
Every
hard.
Guy likes. To do it to a girl, and they say, if they start going, oh, it hurts, and you go, oh, I'm sorry. You're boom. Really going, yeah.
All right. See,
now you're going to pay for everything any woman's ever done to me.
Now, here is a man who can legitimize something I've said to my mother.
All right. This should be fantastic.
Now, I said it in such a way it sounds fucking horrible right from the get-go, right?
Yeah, it does.
But here's the truth. My mother and I are very close. She's good. We've always had an open relationship to where, you know, I'm 16 years old. She walks in in the middle of the night, catches my girlfriend naked on top of the sheets, you know. No, geez, no. But we, you know, talking about sex or talking about my girlfriends or anything like that, she's always been fine with. She's just a very open, awesome mom. And I kind of lost where I was going with that. Oh.
Talking about your mother too much. That's what happens.
Oh, no. I had mentioned to my mom, we were talking about sex, and she was bitching about my father, who they had just gotten a divorce. And I said, well, you do know that a part of sex for a guy is humiliation of the woman. There is a bit of it. Now, it can run the spectrum. Whether a guy is totally getting off because he's demoralizing you.
No, I don't go for that. Or but
it can be very, very, very shy. But when you go, oh, like it hurts, and a guy gets off, that's because just a sliver of him likes the fact that he's doing something to you.
Right. Exactly. That you may or may not like.
But that is an aspect of men.
It's kind of like when they're doing the other dude and they choke a little bit.
They got the pucker. When your cheeks puff out like that, it's like it.
I don't care what, and you'll push their head a little bit harder than the next. True.
It's true.
Amen. Preach on, preacher.
We're all going straight to hell. This is horrible.
Now, I do know that there's a few ladies that I work with that listen to this.
Yeah.
And I told you.
It's explicit. Listen to him.
And I was not prepared. I was not prepared. This is fantastic. I'm loving every second of it. And I think Denise, the sex therapist, would like it too. I mean, I think an honest conversation about stuff like this is what it's all about. And we talked about earlier about people being overly sensitive and worrying about. I mean, you would hope that women would have. I know that at least my wife and her friends have some of these similar conversations. It's not man hating conversations or anything like that. It's more of like. Just what they like, what they don't like kind of thing, and being okay about it.
I'll tell you what happened last weekend.
I can't wait.
It was Sunday night. Did you bring pictures?
Super Bowl. God damn it. And I'm with this girl. She's like 29. And there's a Super Bowl party going over next door in the hotel room next to me. So I told her, I said, they were being so loud. I said, you scream everything that I'm doing to you. Scream it. And within 2 minutes, the TV was off. And you could have heard a pin drop over there. Every once in a while, I'd hear, oh, my God. And this went on for a long time.
I got to say, that feeling or that story or that situation, if that were to ever fucking happen to me, if I could ever say the next day, can you believe we did that last night? Isn't that funny? You screamed what I was doing to you, and I told you to do it.
Oh, it's cool.
And we affected those people in the room next to you have the story of the week.
Right.
Well, you would never fucking believe.
All of them come piling out like they were getting ice.
And they're done.
Everybody in the hallway.
I just gave them the thumbs up.
And we walked downstairs and came back up, you know. And she goes, that was kind of exciting in a way.
Hell yeah, it was.
And I was yelling shit, and she was yelling stuff, and it was just really
It's good. Fucking liberating, isn't it?
Yeah, especially, it turned me on. It really did, because, I mean, she's, you know, like, eat that, and she, you know, I mean, she's screaming it, you know.
I don't know why I'm so surprised. It's where this whole podcast has been going. So I'm not
You know what? It's not so much surprising. Maybe it is a little bit. It's a little surprising, bit of jealousy.
But it's honest.
You know what? Because I got a squeaky clean reputation.
I really do. I mean,
I do not want to be the downfall.
Now,
to
listen,
Mike Armstrong.
It's kind of funny because everybody thinks I'm like all this super.
Hey, your good. Son is a priest, for heaven's
you
sakes.
Know what? And you know what he says? He goes, no Dad's pun. The only guy I know who can go, hey, go get some milk and pick up a barely legal while you're at it.
Is that a skit? Is that a.
No.
Goddamn, it should be.
I don't even talk about sex in my act. I don't cuss. I don't talk about sex.
You know what? I was wondering when I was pulling up different clips, I was trying to find everything I could on you today. Because really the only two rules at my job is, one, don't fall asleep, and two, don't watch porn.
Yeah.
But we have attentive aids. So I can watch YouTube. I can get on the internet. So I was pulling everything I could up on you, and I'm like, okay, I'm catching a theme here. I haven't heard any swear words.
No, I won't cuss.
And I haven't heard anything too terrible. But I have heard a lot of cop stories.
I always felt when I first started out, my mom, my grandmother might come in. And then after they died, I said, well, somebody else has got a mom, somebody else has got a grandmother, so I'll just keep it clean.
I like that.
And it doesn't hurt your act? It's still funny?
Actually, it hurt me in the beginning because nobody would hire me because I was too clean.
Oh, really?
They go, well, we just don't know what kind of act you really are, you know?
Well, they say the easiest laugh is just to swear and, you know, say something stupid. I mean,
I feel like if your punchline ends with fuck, then it's not a good joke.
Sure.
I could write dick jokes all day long, mm-hmm. but try to write good, clean ones takes a while.
Right. Yeah.
And that's what I do.
Do you have your like standard ones that just do really well?
Mean, and I'm always ad-libbing because I want to write. I never write a joke down either. Because I feel like if I can't remember, it's not worth keeping. These guys have notebooks and they're recording, and I'm like, I ain't going through all that crap, you know.
Well, that's a real testament to it. There's different things for you. Don't have to be a certain way to be a comedian or a successful comedian.
And you go in different areas, and if you can't do different jokes, I mean, I did a 5-minute bit about my dad, and it was a true story about my dad, me going to South Dakota. He was worried to death. Because he thinks they're all cowboys. And he goes, Mike, did you tell your brothers where you're going? I go, no. And he goes, well, tell your brothers, tell your sons, tell their cousins. I'll tell your uncles. He goes, they're all cowboys. He goes, and you're going to go to jail, and they are not lynching one of my sons. And he's serious. He was serious.
Now, see, if I was a young man doing comedy and going to Kentucky— My father my father may say a similar thing to me, but not so much that they're from that they're cowboys. It might be more along the lines of ding, 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 ding,
you know,
ding,
and that's
ding.
What everybody thinks too. And we like it. We want you.
It is fun. It is funny
because you know, I'll, like if some of my northern friends come down, I'll go, "My dog's getting a sit in case you run."
Oh, that's awesome.
Boy, you got a pretty mouth.
Well, now, I mean, Kentucky is considered the South, but it's do you like working in the Midwest? Do you like Midwest crowds? How are they? Yeah.
I like Midwest. Probably the only state I really don't care for is New York.
Really? Just assholes or what?
They're just, I don't know. They're too up in your face when they talk, you know. Like, one night, I didn't know if a girl wanted to punch me or what. She come running up on me. You're awesome, you know, and she was real hot, and I was like, "Oh man, I couldn't get past that voice. Even if you took your clothes off, I couldn't get awesome."
Scream when I'm doing even to you. No, stop. Actually, I reconsider.
Even when she's saying, she's screaming everything you say.
It's like New Jersey housewives is what it was. Everywhere, and I hated it.
Yeah.
And California, I'm like real popular in like Sacramento and.
I'm from the Bay Area.
There's a lot.
That's awesome.
I'm real big there.
Do you ever get nervous that you're going to go to a club and you're and?
I don't do that many clubs. I do mostly corporate and small theaters, like 700 seat theaters.
Really?
Yeah, I don't hardly do clubs at all.
Just moved out of that.
And if I do, I go one show. I tell them one show Friday and Saturday. That's it. I ain't doing any more. I get part of the door, and we move on with life. Yeah. You know?
And how did you hook up with Jeff?
I don't know, to tell you the truth.
You know what's funny is you were making a comment earlier about what a good guy is.
Oh, he's a great guy.
He's a great guy.
You know what? And he'll take the money out of his pocket if you get screwed over. So and I've never met an agent that would do that.
I've never met a guy that he came to us and I said, "Hey, would you if I give you a shout on email, would you have a couple comics come on our show?" You're like our eighth comic. He just fucking filters things through.
He's started?
Awesome.
You know how the fact that you're here tonight all started about a year ago because his son is on my son's baseball team.
Huh.
And when we first started doing the podcast, I thought, we should really go down to Penguins because that would be funny. That would be fun to have comedians come on and just talk, get to know them. Who are they? You know, they could do their lines if they want to, you know, be funny, or they can just hang out. I would love to just hang out. And about 6 months later, I realized the guy who's standing right next to me watching the kids play baseball, he
owns Penguins.
He owns Penguins.
Yeah.
And so one day
– he owns a lot.
Yeah, he does.
So one day my kid gets hurt, and I'm one of those dads that I know me. And if I get involved, I go over the top. I get stupid, right?
Really?
I just get too
– it's an army in you.
I'm just like, hey, let's go. Pay attention. Come on, guys. Let's – you know, and I ruin it. I know that I put a negative tone on things. So I purposely pull myself away almost to where I'm completely ignoring – what's going on the basketball court or the baseball field. And at one point, one of my sons had twisted his ankle, had gone down, and all the other parents rush over. And because I pulled myself away from this, I'm like playing, I don't know. I'm playing like Angry Birds or some bullshit on my phone. I'm like, oh, what's going on? What? Oh, shit, it's my kid. And from that, Jeff and I start talking. And I go, oh, so what do you do, Jeff? And he told me, I go, oh, shit. Dude, I've been thinking about actually talking to you, and I didn't even realize that you did what you did for months. And he goes, oh, yeah, just give me a call.
Yeah, we'll Jeff's see what's really going on.
And you sent me an email and said, hey, do you want to email this guy and find out how it would work? And I was like, sure.
And I get his dad going all the time.
Now, I've never met his dad.
His dad is so funny. He's the greatest guy. But he's always wanting to know who I'm banging. Yeah.
Well, I want to know who you're banging all the time now, too. And I never thought I'd get to that point.
I might annoy you now that you friended me on Facebook.
Exactly. I want some private messages with some pictures.
I don't ever show pictures. And sometimes I put up pictures and say I'm dating just to keep the women away. So I'll have a friend of mine, or I got a couple of lesbian friends, and I'll say, hey, we're engaged or something, you know. And they're cops, so it kind of takes the heat off of them a little
bit. They're lesbian cops who are friends of yours. No wonder your son wants you to have a movie in Vegas when you have lesbian cops for friends. No, Jesus Christ.
My son goes, I can't think of a sitcom. Fool around with that one? I go, yeah, we did one night, and it was good. And then the next day she
was like, no.
I think we both still like women. So
at least you tried, and she tried with you. That's all that matters.
And that's where you learn the sacred rule of if your hair's not wet from here to here, you got it from her.
Well, right? She brought her friend, too, which was kind of fun.
Have you had more than – is a threesome a common thing for you?
Is there sometimes.
Is Vegas one of those things?
No, actually, it's usually in little small towns. Like the last one.
Do you need a bodyguard? Do you need a bodyguard?
Sometimes I do have bodyguards. Last time I had like two sisters, I was in North Dakota.
Is that kind of weird? Two sisters?
I was trying to get them to kiss each other and they wouldn't do it.
Well, that's fucked up.
Hold on a second.
Kiss your sister. Hold on. This is not Kentucky, Mike.
This is what I don't.
It was cool.
I've never been able to wrap my head around this when somebody says something about, sisters. I've never understood when sisters, when you have two ladies and you're having sex with both ladies and both ladies are sisters, yet they're not touching each other.
Right.
Yeah, but it's still fun.
Well, I can only imagine.
See, I'm thinking you're going to need security at some point, and we'll be happy to help you on the road.
Or I was in a small cowboy town. It literally was a cowboy town, and nothing around for 150, 200 miles. And women outnumbered guys like 20 to 1.
That's hot right there.
And the guy goes, you're going to get laid. And I wasn't there an hour, and I met two sisters. They asked me to sit down with them in a restaurant.
Hold on a second. Let me get a paper in hand.
And I said,
we're both married. Shut up.
Where exactly is that at?
But I'm not afraid to say it. What are they going to do? Say no and right. Go on. So
yeah.
I go, hey, why don't y'all come over and let's all get naked, man. Let's do this.
And they don't you think that's 95% of the journey is just saying it?
Yeah, and see, I'm not afraid to say it.
It's the confidence. It's absolutely the confidence of being honest.
I was up in, where was I? I was in Lansing, Michigan, and these two hot girls walked in, and they were black. And I said,
you got me at black.
I said, I'm going to hit on that one. He said, you ain't got a shot because they're too hot. So I just walked by her, and I said, I'm a big fan of yours. And she goes, I'm not a singer or an actor. I go, no, I'm a big fan of yours. There it went. That was it. All you got to do is break the ice.
And you weren't belittling her. You're being straight up and honest. I mean, I can see why somebody would be down with that.
And then he seen her do the walk of shame the next morning when he was gone. And he hated me.
You son of a bitch.
Yeah, he hated me. He really did.
Now,
and
see,
I know I'm a little old guy and I'm overweight.
If that would have happened with Todd, if he would have shot my chance with Perky, and then I would have woke up the next day and Perky would have been walking away out of his room, I'd have been pissed. But that didn't happen.
But you could be proud of him at the same time.
I think that you need some videos taken of you while you're on the road, and we, sir, are almost always open or will make time.
You know what? I'm always talking shit. I can't stop. I really cannot stop. I mean, a waitress, you know, I'll start talking. Me and my sons went out. We're down in Georgia, in Delonica, where the Ranger Camp is, Camp Merrill.
Mm-hmm.
And we go to it was an Applebee's, and we're sitting there. And before the dinner's over, the waitress is sitting with me, and I got my arm around her, and she's going, how long are you going to be? And you know what I told her? I said, sometimes I just feel like I just want to end it all. Yeah, that's how the conversation started. And she goes,
what a great icebreaker.
And she goes, don't be that way. And I go, well, then why you look so good? I go, don't come over here looking that good. And I said, I just want to end it. Because I know I'm never going to be with you, you know? And I'm saying,
you fucking player, dude.
And they're just staring at me like, good God. But they didn't block me.
Yeah. It's my move.
Yeah,
it's my move.
You know, my ex-wife blocked me.
Do you get along with your ex-wife now or no?
We just don't talk to each other.
Okay.
And so, yeah, they get along fine.
But you know what? Talk. Here's the beauty of it all. She's gained like 105 pounds. Mm. And she's got a twin sister. Her twin sister still weighs like 105. So I call them before and after. And that makes her mad.
Why?
Well, you know
Why
what?
Would that make her mad? I don't get it. I don't understand.
Well, you know what? In your situation, it worked out great. My ex-wife, before we divorced, before we separated, she would go on tirades about – she would see a woman with fake breasts, and she would go on tirades. Oh, my God, that's terrible. That's horrible. I can't believe she's got so low self-esteem. Blah, 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 blah. Here I am just admiring the view.
Oh, yeah.
Of course.
After the divorce, what does she do? She starts competing in Miss Fitness competitions, gets fake breasts, never looks more beautiful. And that's a compliment to you. I know every now and then you'll watch the show and you
But you don't feel nothing toward her, do you?
No.
See, I don't feel no hate. I don't feel no nothing. I mean, it's like she's somebody I used to know. In high school or something.
It is odd as you get older that you look back and go, I can't even imagine that was my life.
See, I have an ex-wife before her. I was only married like 6 months. Me and her get along fine. And we had a child, a little girl, and she's not little anymore. But and we just said, hey, we shouldn't have got married. We were like 16, 17. Mm-hmm. And she goes, you're going to be the bare parent. You take her, and I'll give you $45 a week child support. And never, ever missed. And we get along great. Wow. I mean, she's married to like one of my friends now.
Really?
Yeah, because we were over at my daughter's house one night, and my ex-wife, first one, goes, Mike, well, you want a sandwich? And I go, sure. And she goes, what do you want on? And I go, you know what daddy likes. Everybody laughed at her husband. Because I always mess with him. I go, does she still like to, you know, like. And he'll go, shut up.
That's a yes.
Now, Mike, maybe the second or third time that I had hung out with this guy over here, Todd, he grew up with my first wife.
Hmm. All right, we're still friends.
Yeah, and that's how I met him, was through my first wife. And so he's coming over to the house with his wife. You were married at the time, correct?
Yeah.
You were coming over to my girlfriend's house, and right before he gets there, she says to me, by the way, Todd and I had sex. We dated. We dated and we had sex. But I was 18, right?
Yep.
So stupid. Young guy. So Todd shows up with his first wife, and my girlfriend at the time, soon to be first wife, says, hey guys, why don't you go get some munchies? You know, go do a grocery store run real quick and we'll see you in a little bit. So we get in the car. He starts driving. I'm in the passenger seat, and I just look at him.
And he doesn't even try to break the ice like we're having. So
I'm just staring at him. He doesn't even really know me. Right? He doesn't really know me at all.
Nope.
And from the get-go, this is how I broke the ice with him.
So
I hear you used to fuck. I hear you used to fuck my girlfriend. And he did this.
I can remember driving up. I can remember driving up Johnson Avenue in Iowa City. Thomas Jefferson Avenue. Going,
is he going to hit me?
Why is this conversation fucking happening? Where did this come from?
I remember specifically you telling me later, going, I thought at any moment, is this fucking guy going to hit me? As I'm driving, and here I'm just dying. I'm laughing inside because I thought it'd be super funny.
And that was funny. All right,
that was his first experience. That's
funny.
Yeah,
and you're homophobia at the time,
and that I was super homophobic, but I've gotten over that.
Yeah. Oh, really?
I was super homophobic when I was younger.
You were sheltered. Let's put it that way.
I've never been that way. I just never even thought about it.
And there was.
Yeah, me too.
I don't want to get into why I was homophobic, but when I got into. When I was in the military, I went overseas and went to Israel. I was a part of a group that won a competition in the Sinai Desert. It was multinational force and observers, the MFO, for all of those of you that know what the fuck that means. Anyway, we did a competition. It was kind of like the Olympics for that area. There was 11 different contingencies, countries, Italians and, you know, just a bunch of different people. And we had to do all these different tasks as a competition. The Americans won it. For the first time in like 7 years, we won it. And our reward was to go to Israel, Eilat, Israel, for a week to hang out. And it was like the first night I was there, we found this bar called, I think, The Cave. And it was just packed, except for one table, and there was one guy at the table. And I go over to the table, like, hey, do you speak English? She's like, yeah, I speak English. She goes, I used to live in Miami. Great, that's awesome. Do you mind if me and my buddies kind of hang out with you and drink some beer? He's like, yeah, sure, no problem. I forget what his name was, but it was a female. It was a girl's name.
Kelly. Kelly.
No.
Can go both ways.
No, it wasn't Kelly. It wasn't Kelly, but I tried to pronounce. I said it in a way. He told me, like, God damn, I'd fuck it up right now. He told me what his name was, and I go, oh, and I mispronounced it to try to make it sound masculine. He goes, no.
Victoria.
Like, something like that, you know? And I was like, oh, all right. So so I met some girls. You know, all the guys were dancing with girls on the dance floor and we're drinking. And this girl who I was dancing with leans into me and she goes, I think your friend is into you. I go, what? Who? And I turn around and there's this guy. He's just, he's not looking at my face. He's not looking at this. But he was really into me. And at that moment, I got over the homophobia. I was like, you know what? I can have a great time with this person. I don't give a shit what he does.
And I think you even said to him something like, hey, man, you know, I'm straight. Didn't you make a comment to him?
Yeah, I did. I had said, nothing's going to happen between you and I. He's like, that's okay. I'm like, oh, okay. And nothing did happen. And at that moment, I've just never been uncomfortable. Around a gay person ever since then. But before that moment, I would get pissed. Like I would get upset and I would start sweating.
Dude, you're from Iowa. It's like I've had friends who said they didn't meet a black person until they went to college because they grew up in a small town in Iowa. And their first black person they met was in their dorm, you know, kind of thing. And they're like, oh, they're just like everybody else. It's just if you're not exposed to things, you're not going to be knowledgeable about it.
Right. And until you have your first three-way with a couple of sisters, you're not going to know how great it could feel.
Yeah, it's great. I actually ended up staying another day, extra day.
Just because of the sisters?
Just for the sisters.
I mean, I don't think we even left a room, to tell you the truth.
Good for you.
God bless them.
God bless you, sir. And no blue pills. No blue pills.
No blue pills. Just a ton of yoga and a bunch of water. No, I just water. You have to stay hydrated.
Yeah, because sometimes that can be a sin. I mean, being dehydrated. I'm good. If it's new, I'm good for three in one day. But you know, don't push four.
Mike, I really feel like I need to up my game a little bit. You're really making me feel
inadequate. I feel very inadequate.
Inadequate's a good word.
Girlfriend
inadequate.
I've ever had, it's always been morning and night.
Todd, you continue the conversation.
Because why?
In the morning, before I go to sleep, I got to have, you know, whatever.
And is that something that you kind of like? I mean, it's something that you've been honest and upfront about, obviously, and said, this is what I like, and this is what I like to do. Yeah. You know, this is kind of the way I roll.
Yeah. And it's always been okay.
Oh, and you find the people that are going to fit that role. I mean, that's the best idea about it, being honest, right?
You just got to let them know they fit that role. See, I really feel like all guys and all women want to do it. It's just they're afraid that people will think they're weird, you know?
Really?
You know, it's just like, I don't want to get gross or nothing.
You don't have to, you can say whatever the fuck you want to say.
I dated this Asian girl. And she looked like she was just out Playboy. And she liked a little bit of finger in her butt. She goes, I can't just say, hey, I like a little bit of finger in my butt.
And you're like, fuck, yeah, you can.
I go, sure you can, you know. And,
right.
But she would tell me all kinds of creepy stuff. I mean, she would go, pour this on me, you know. Do that.
Really?
Yeah.
But I mean, but I bet you anything, it was probably liberating.
Doctor.
It was probably, so she's even more closed up than the average person.
Yeah, but she turned loose.
See, I guess I had kind of have to agree with you. I think that most people, I think they're liberated with the idea that, oh, so I can just tell you what I want, and you're gonna you're gonna say, you're not gonna go, oh, what the fuck's wrong with you? You're gonna be like, well, hey, you know what? I'm glad you're into that, but maybe I'm not. Or maybe you're gonna say, hey, I'll give that a try.
Yeah, I'll take a shot at it.
Why not?
Why not? That's the way I am. I go, sure.
I'm gonna guess that the reason why you're so successful, to put it in polite terms, is because you're honest and straightforward.
I'm real honest about stuff, about that kind of stuff. You know, it's just like, and when I was in Dubuque, I told this one woman, I said, if you lived near me, I'd be chasing after you. I said, I'd buy you a car, whatever you want. She goes, oh, you want me to come to the show? And I said, no, because I got to leave in the morning. I'm tired.
You're going to work me out.
I know what's going to happen.
I got to start being more upfront with my lady.
Yeah, especially if you're married. There should be nothing held back.
Nothing
at all.
Do you think you'll find that? Do you think you'll ever find that person again where you'd want to get married because you're that upfront? You've got these things figured out,
or is life just too
great
for you right now?
It sounds pretty fucking awesome.
I get bored with them after a couple of days.
Okay,
and no, I think that's my problem. Me and my sons, we talked about it. We were talking on the phone. And this is why I was coming to Iowa. And they said, Dad, you just get bored with them too quick. Because they say something and you go, I'm done with them. You know? And that's what, I mean, I was dating a playmate and she called me during the UK game, basketball game.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I asked you not to call me, text me. And this is the first game of the season. And she goes, well, I really need to talk to you. There's nothing that important. I said, we're done. And my son goes, you're giving up a play. My pre-son goes, you're giving up this playmate because she called you during the year. I go, the season's just started.
I got standards, young man.
I'm not going to be bothered.
Well, here's the thing, though. If you lay down the ground rules, if you're open and honest, like you're saying that you are, and you tell the expectations, you say, these are the expectations, and they break them, see ya.
You know,
isn't that kind of the trappings of a bad relationship, though?
Yeah.
You set down the ground rules, and then they break them, and you're like, okay. Yeah.
You know, I like this other girl, and we dated for like 3 weeks, and I really kind of liked her. But what did she say when we're coming back from Indianapolis? Where do you see us in a year? And I knew where she was going.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, I see you sitting at home going, I wonder whatever happened to Mike. Because when I drop you off, that's it. And that was it.
But do you feel that most women are looking for some kind of commitment?
They're looking for a second income. And I think they feel like they need somebody. The young ones, this is the way I feel about that. The young ones want to do what I've already done. And the older ones want to be that grandma. You know, even when they're like 50, I want to make cookies with my grandchildren or your grandchildren. I don't want to make cookies.
I don't want a mom. I want somebody to have a great time.
I want to wake up and go, hey, you know what? I think I'm going to Vegas. And that's what I do. I wake up and I go, hey, you know, I think I'm going to go fishing. You know? And I'm gone. It might be 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm heading to the lake. I want that freedom to do what I want to do.
You don't think you'll find that person where that rolls over and goes, yeah, I'm down.
I found one. And then she ruined it, and the Asian doctor, and she said,
"The Asian doctor ruined it."
She said, "I want you to quit comedy because she was being transferred to another hospital in North Carolina. She was only 29, and she said, bring your dogs, bring your, you know, Christopher with you, and you know, because I help take care of him." And she goes, "And I'll just take care of all y'all." And I said, "No, because I know what's going to happen. I'm on drop comedy. We're going to live in your big house. You're going to come home after 12 hours complaining. Oh, it must be nice to be sitting around all day, you know. Now I'm under your thumb."
And why would you drop comedy? I mean, that's like asking you to drop what you do for a living.
You know, I could drop comedy in a heartbeat. If I could get...
But don't you like it?
That's a tough one because I've really never been real excited about it. I think that's why I do good in it, because I really don't care.
Oh, okay.
Really? I mean, I turned down TV shows and because I was taking my kids to drive in that night. They go, well, why don't you schedule? I go, I'm going to know my kids a lot longer than I'm going to know you. You know?
So right.
We're done. You know? If you don't want to rebook me, that's fine. I don't care. I've always had that attitude about everything. I'll take a chance.
So what have you ever, is there anything that you've really been really passionate about that you wish you could have done?
Just raising my kids. Making sure they all turned out good.
Well, it sounds like they're doing pretty good. If you have a choice now, though? I mean, so what, if you had a choice, would it be fishing?
I'm fishing. I like to fish. And I like to be by myself when I do it. Or my sons, you know. And I like going to UK basketball game. That's what I always said. I just want to be famous enough to get good seats at Rupp Arena.
Really?
And people send me tickets all the time. You know?
Really?
Oh, yeah.
That's awesome.
And I like to go to the Coats games. I've sat in the owner's box. He called me up one time. Hey, I heard you're a big Coats fan. You want to come on up? And, sure.
See, we need to do some more stuff like that on the podcast. We need to tell people who we're fans of.
You got to watch what you say, though. Because I said I liked Starbucks breakfast blend one time on Bob and Tom. And a post office called me and said, you need to come and get all this stuff. And I said, take what you want and give the rest to the Salvation Army. And they said, okay.
So the Bob and Tom thing was a ginormous leap forward. I mean, you hit that and then boom.
Then all of a sudden every TV show and all that wanted me, you know. And without them, to this day, if they ever stopped using me, I would be in the dipper. I know that.
Yeah?
They're that powerful. They're in every state in the union. You know?
Isn't that amazing that...
Are they good dudes?
The best.
Awesome.
I've seen some of their early videos on YouTube to where their studio is, it looks like a closet. It's so small.
Yeah. No,
right.
They have a great studio now.
Yeah, yeah. I looked at their
studio. Monstrous.
Yeah, I look at their studio now and I go, hey. Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. They got the best of everything. They have a chef that comes in and makes their food for them in the morning.
Now, that'd be a hell of a
someday, buddy,
gig, get to that kind of
level.
You never know.
You never know, really. I mean, you guys are good at what you're doing, or I'd have been gone about an hour.
I really appreciate
that.
I
appreciate that, too.
You. Yeah, thank you, Mike.
I even told Jeff, I go, if I feel like they don't know what they're doing, I'm out of there. And he says, it's okay.
Hey, you know what? Our whole thing is just having a conversation with somebody, getting to know them.
The same way you said, this is us.
Yeah.
We're not fucking around. Yeah. It's just
anybody who admit they blocked their best friend and then banged his ex-wife. Good God.
Yeah.
And you're still friends.
You know what? I never did find out. Was she good? Was she good back then?
Yeah, it's really inappropriate.
I know, but
what
else
did you do? 16, I'm just kind of curious.
They were 16 years old.
I was 18. She was 16.
Wait a second. You were 18. She was 16. Now it's completely different.
Did she do oral sex on you?
Yeah, you took
she it. Did.
Oh my God!
Did she take it all the way?
It's hard to remember because it was so damn long ago, to be quite honest.
Does her mom know?
Her mom was excited about it because she thought that, oh, this is the person that she'll end up with. And
so you was hitting it a lot.
And she, no. I wish it was a lot. It was not a lot. It was like once or twice and that was it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And she dumped me. It wasn't the other way around. She was done with me because I'm one of those like dumbass googly eyed. I fall in love like that. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'm the opposite of you, Mike, obviously.
I'm cold hearted and I wished I wasn't. I wished I could find somebody.
Well, okay. Well, wait. Hold on a second. Now, there's two views here. There's the view of
whatever you're pouring over there. Can I have one?
No, I drank it all. You only gave me four.
Only four.
Now listen.
But he's home. So.
Yeah. Thank you. Now this is the text message I sent you earlier. Make sure you grab a plethora.
No. It wasn't plethora.
Okay. All right, you read it. Tell me what I said.
Can you grab a montage?
A montage. Thank you.
Of good beers. Who the fuck says montage?
And then
plethora means a lot of beer.
Okay,
I
said montage.
Montage means like
what?
Mix it up.
Yeah. How many did you buy?
Six.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
Because you drink 10 beers at a podcast doesn't mean that I can't partake of two
now,
or three.
The fact that Mike is having a great time, I'm glad he is, and he's drinking his A&W root beer over there.
I did ask. I offered.
That's so awesome. Know. But I generally, because Mike, you'll, you might not know this.
You'll be surprised about this. Go ahead.
You might not know this, Mike, but I get really, I get a lot of anxiety.
Really? About this.
Because I want to do a really good job. I want people to have a great time. I want to be prepared. I want things to come off. Now, showing up 15, 20 minutes late to a podcast, no that's that doesn't bode well.
Well, you got but I'm with you. I'm more like you. I'm more of like, I tell him all the time, it's just a podcast. We're just going to get to know this person. We're going to have a great time.
Yeah, you know what? I go on Bob and Tom. They're nationwide.
Mm-hmm.
And every comic sweats it so bad when they go in there because there's a lot of pressure.
Sure.
Well, yeah, it's going to make or break you, right?
I go in with no preparation. I might have just woke up 20 minutes earlier.
With pussy still on your face.
And I go in, and I have a great time. And I always go, I'm just going to stay an hour. And I end up staying four because I'm bullshitting so much.
Right.
Well, and we're having a good time.
Do you ever have a hard time being careful?
I don't.
With what you say, I mean.
Do you ever feel like you have to censor yourself?
I know when to turn it on and turn it off. I know when you can't cuss, I won't cuss.
Okay.
But I cuss like a sailor.
That'd be hard for me because I swear kind of.
Seeing all my kids cuss like sailors, and
even the priest.
Yeah, oh, he's the worst.
God, I love that. I just love that. I really like the kid. And I don't even know.
I like the kid, and I love Catholic schoolgirls.
I love them too.
Because they're.
See, I dated a girl that was a cop, and she was a fitness instructor.
So I'm liking this story.
Is that why your back's bad?
We're dating, and she's like 6 foot two.
All right.
Blonde hair.
Did it hurt your neck?
Oh, it was a beautiful thing. We're still good friends. But she calls me up, and she goes, on your way home, I need you to stop by.
All right.
Well, I stop by, and she's got her Catholic girl uniform on.
Yes.
So she handcuffs me to the bed.
Fuck yeah. Keep going.
And she'd been taking, like, tanning booth, going to the tanning booth all week.
Yeah.
And she goes, now lick the white parts. So,
yeah, Mike, I'm on your Facebook. I'm going to message you. Mike, what are you doing tonight?
I'm going to have to sit here for a little while.
Mike, what are you doing tonight?
I'm going to sit here for 15 minutes.
And my son, that's a priest, he goes, where you been? And I go, well, I stopped by. And he's seen the cuff marks. And he goes, never mind.
I'll pray for you right now, Dad.
Oh, God bless you. Does he ever, God bless you, Dad.
No, he always goes, my son. I go, don't my son that crap to me. His name's Christopher. He'll go, remember, I have Christ in my name. Shit.
Don't pull that on me or I'll stop. I'm not going to tell you more stories.
I call him St. Christopher.
That's awesome. What a unique relate. My face hurts from some
dude.
From
the dynamics,
so hard.
The dynamics of that.
To be
like to go out. I just keep coming back to the sister montage. to go have a sister montage, and then you come home. And you're like, hey son, how you doing? He's got his priest thing on. You want to know what I did last night?
Yeah. All right. Well, he told me. He goes, don't tell me because I get tired of it. Because his mother asked him, she goes, because I was truly in love with his mom.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I never cheated on her. And she goes, she said this at Christmas, is your dad finally going to see somebody? And he goes, I'm just going to say it straight up, Mom. He's fucking everybody. He goes, every state, bam, bam, bam. She goes, oh, my God, your father's...
Now is she at all surprised? Do you think?
Oh yeah, because I was a loyal servant.
No.
Okay.
Well, maybe. Well, I was gonna say maybe she's not surprised because you guys were having sex like six times a week.
Yeah, but she thought it was her because I really was in love with their mom. I mean, I truly was in love with their mom.
Yeah.
I mean, no ifs, ands, or buts, and. And then when that one day happened, I felt nothing for her at all. Just like nothing.
Boom.
Because I truly
think 32 years of devotion.
I think she was talking to somebody on Facebook, like an old boyfriend or something.
You know what? I'm sorry. I have to clear this up. I'm confused. This woman that you're talking about right now, was she the woman that you were married to for 5 years or for 32 years?
I was only married 6 months first.
Yeah, the first one was super short.
Yeah.
All right. There's a lot of marriages going
on. So this is a long term.
6 months.
Yeah. 32 years is a long time.
I really thought we were like, everybody thought we were like the Leave It to Beaver family, you know, like June and War, you know.
Right.
And then, bam.
Wouldn't that be an amazing sitcom? The spinoff to Leave It to Beaver, where Ward goes off and starts fucking sisters.
2 days before that, we were talking about adopting three little boys.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you not feel comfortable telling it? What happened? Or is that just something you want to keep to yourself?
No, that's okay. I'm fine with it. I think she was talking to an old high school boyfriend on Facebook, and then they started texting each other, and the texting got out of hand. And I said, stop it. And she said, well, we're just friends. I said, you know, me being an ex-cop, I checked. And I said, y'all text each other in 1 month over 2,000 times.
That's more than just a casual conversation.
And I'm sure they were talking, you know, if I was single, you were saying blah, 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 blah.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And I said, well, here's your opportunity. Hit it. And she said, well, I think maybe we should part ways. And I said, okay. And then she called me. She went and filed for divorce. This happened on a Sunday. She filed for divorce on Monday.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, she called him, and he said, no, I'm just flirting on the phone. And then she called me and said, you want to get back together? And I said, no. I said, damage is done.
You've already started down
that road. I can never trust you again.
Right.
I go, and that's what's made this marriage last so long, is because we trusted each other. And, you know, I said, no more. I said, you do your thing. She's still living with her mom.
And do you feel like that, not that you're having sex to counteract things, do you feel like that's why it's hard for you to find somebody, that other person again, because you were so, I mean, that's pretty incredible to be that devoted.
I think I have trust issues. But I don't blame her.
Well, I wasn't trying to say you had trust issues. I was just kind of saying that maybe that's why it's harder to find that one person, because you had it. I mean, you had it for 32 years.
I was so loyal and everything for so long that I just don't want to be that way.
Sure.
I never really got to do what I wanted to do. Everything was taking care of my kids, taking care of making sure she was happy. And then all of a sudden, she's not there. My kids are gone. Now it's me. And I don't mind really being alone.
Right.
And everybody goes, oh, aren't they lonely? I go, no.
You've had 32 years. This is double the amount normal people
have. I'm 63 years old.
You know, you might be a perfect example of something that I felt for a long time, which is we have sucked ourselves into these social norms. You have to be married.
Yeah.
You have to feel guilty if you get a divorce. You have to have you have to fill these certain roles in your life. And men are made to fuck.
Yeah.
It's true.
But I think women are too.
Exactly. But
they just don't.
But in today's day and age, we are meant to feel guilty. You should feel guilty if a really attractive woman walks by you in the mall, or a really attractive woman walks by you and you're working in the company business place, you know, you're not supposed to look at her. Were you just sexually harassing her? No, I'm a dude, and she looks like she's fertile, and I would like to... I'm not harassing her.
Well, you know what? I seen a woman at the mall 2 months ago, and we're friends right now. And I was Christmas shopping, and I walked up to her, and I said, I know I'm never going to see you again. Would you like to have lunch? I'm going to take a shot. She said, sure. And she goes, I don't date anybody. And we talked, and she goes, I just don't date anybody. She goes, I don't meet anybody. She goes, because everybody's afraid to talk to me.
Yeah.
She was kind of wild looking. And I liked it.
I'd say, it sounds like you have pretty good taste in me, buddy.
And again, that's like 95% of the reward is just breaking that ice.
And I'm not afraid to do it.
And being just a person, just being yourself.
You know,
I tell them, I said, you know, I'm harmless, which I really am. You know, and I'll walk you to your car and you're fine. And if you don't want to talk to me ever again, that's fine too. You know, I don't care.
Now, I know you don't need a wingman.
I know that.
I got the real strong feeling you don't need a wingman.
No, now, you know what? Not. I travel alone.
Oh, we'll meet you there. We'll meet you there.
But I tell you what, my uncle is the epitome. You know what? He would really love to go to your – he would really love this podcast, and he would really love to follow you on a social norm because
see, I don't put it out there.
What he does, one of his most famous things that he told me about was he would go to a grocery store, and he'd do his normal grocery shopping.
That's but best if, place.
Yeah. But if there was a hot – if there was a beautiful lady that he would love to bed, he would wait. He would see her, and he would wait – in the chocolate chip aisle.
And she came down.
And he would have two different packages of chocolate chips. Completely different.
This is a good story.
Fuck yeah, it is. I was always impressed. When he told me this story, I was like, you're the godfather. Until Mike, of course. I thought, you were the godfather. He would have two completely different packages of chocolate chips. And she would come walking down. And as she approached, he would turn to her and say, I'm trying to make chocolate chip cookies for my granddaughter. You know, all of a sudden that sucks her in. It's just a sweet, aw, moment. Can you help me? Which chocolate chips would be the best? And how should I make these, really? He goes, before you know it, she's walking me through the grocery store. We've got all the ingredients. And then we're sitting down at the deli having lunch.
Yeah.
I go, really? He goes, well, then we're fucking.
Yeah, you got to put that part in there.
Yeah,
what I do?
Because what's the goal? The goal. I mean, that's the goal.
Well, the biggest thing though is breaking the ice. And
see, I go down the dog aisle, and I go, oh, not my the dog likes chips. Those treats too. Just me and my two little doggies. I always say that. Without them, I don't know what I'd do. What kind of dogs you have?
Oh, let me show you some pictures. Do you like doggy style?
Oh, wait. Hold on a second. How'd that slip in there?
Or I'll have my earphones in, and I act like I'm singing a love song.
We're getting all the juicy.
We are.
Icebreaker. This is all how you do it. Now, Todd, I know that someday you'll be divorced.
That's such a horrible thing to say. God.
You're bad news. You know the fact that this is all being recorded, I'm saying this to the future you. Now just rewind a bit and listen to what Mike said. So when you go to the grocery store next, it's not a big deal. Just go to either one of two aisles, either the chocolate chip aisle or
the doggy treat.
The dog.
Now, you know, between the two of us, I have a much worse hard time meeting people than I do.
Me?
Even with your personality.
Now, listen.
You're much more kind of internal than I am.
I am kind of an inclusive type.
No.
Inclusive means you're helped me out, though.
Yeah?
Like, I was talking to a woman one day.
Your sons?
They helped me.
That a boy?
Like, those boys. I said, we just got back from their mom's graveyard. I go there every month.
We were talking about honesty earlier.
And my sons would go, we've been trying to get him to go out with women, but he just he's ready, but we just can't find anybody. You know, they
you old son of
you know what year. Here's the thing, I don't want my wife to die. I don't,
but it's
I
a
don't.
Perk if she
I
does.
Am happily married and I love you. I do.
But if it happens,
but
everybody else beware.
But I'm just saying, if something horrible, and listen, I podcast all the time, and I have witnesses that I'm here. But if something horrible were to happen, and my sons, as they get older, are trying to set me up.
Yeah, but my ex-wife isn't dead. That's beautiful.
I'm just throwing out a scenario,
she
Mike.
She doesn't have to die.
I'm just throwing out a scenario. She doesn't have to die.
But if she did.
No, I'm just – but
– we used that one quite a bit.
That is – you got to admit, that's awesome. That's really cool fun to have your sons.
And then you give them that smile like you're really happy to see them just for that 1 second again when you're walking down it.
It's a beautiful thing, man.
I guess so. Holy shit.
You know, and I never thought I'd be this way. I mean, if you'd have talked to me 6 years ago, I'd have went, I don't know.
No, that'll never happen.
Yeah.
I mean, I get that. That's why I think that the time you devoted to somebody and the loyalty you had for somebody, and then it went south so badly, why would you not be like, I'm good. I'm going to do what I want to do now. Yeah, that makes total sense. 32 years, that's a long fucking time to be married,
period. Well, you know, she actually thought that we took her good years away from her, you know, and I never understood that.
You don't think that women feel that way
in general? I think once they hit in the 50s, they start thinking, you know, I've lost it, you know. And then they hear about their friends are making up bullshit, how they had a good time when they went out on Saturday, and how they took their little trips to Brown County or whatever, you know. And they go, I'm missing all that because I'm married and got kids, you know.
Do you ever hook up with women that are more towards your age, or do you stick with
them? No. Because they're all old.
Well, I gathered that part.
Yeah, but they look it.
Oh.
And you know,
dude, all right. Wait a second.
That's true.
If you had the choice, all right, I know I'm 40, but I feel like I'm still in my 20s. I've seen
very attractive 40-year-olds. I'm sure they're attractive 60-year-olds.
I'm good.
I'm not saying that he has to date within his age group. I'm saying that.
But women in my age group are like old grandmas.
Okay. Gotcha.
And they're like,
well, you don't approach
it. You don't want it. The thing is, you don't, as a single man, you don't want a grandmother.
No.
You want a woman that wants to have fun.
Right.
Yeah. And they don't know how.
Period.
And most of them are younger.
And they, the older ones don't know how to have fun because they've been married all their life and they're kind of like been slaves all their lives.
Yeah.
To these grouchy old guys that sit on their, you know, lazy boys and drink beer until they go to sleep, you know, sit in the dark and, you know, watch TV. And I'm not that way. I'm like, hey,
let's go have a good time.
I'll send a limo to you just when you get off work. And there'd be a ticket for an airplane, you know, and the limo driver, I've already got your clothes in Vegas. You know, it's a surprise. You know, that's the kind of stuff I like to do.
Well, that's sexy. Not that I'm going to have sex with you, Mike. Don't even try to put the moves on me. But
it might work.
That's the scary part. It might work. He's got some magic. My ex-wife
hated that kind of stuff.
Did she really?
She'd go, why are you doing that? That's a waste of money. I don't want to go to Vegas. I don't want to do this, you know. You know, just... You know, and I was always doing stuff.
Even with the big house and enjoying life like that?
I'm very romantic. Believe it or not, I'm a romantic. If I like a woman, I treat her like a queen. I mean, she never, whatever she wants, she's going to get.
Yes, but there are some demands, Mike.
But, you know, you know, and I can afford it, so I do it.
Yeah.
You know, like the Asian doctor, I had I picked her up from work, and I already got it cleared where she didn't have to work at the hospital. She had clothes and I took her to Gatlinburg. We spent the weekend in Gatlinburg. I rented a cabin. And, you know, I do stuff like that. And she really liked it, you know.
But, which is why it's surprising for me.
Who
to
the fuck
her.
Wouldn't like that?
Well, but then she turned around and said, hey, I want you to stop comedy and move somewhere else. But then it would change the things that you did all right, for
her. Yeah,
that
she's like, gotcha.
That's what I mean.
But that's what you're assuming. I mean, Mike was assuming if I fell into that trap of life, of livelihood, where you're supporting me, then I would feel like I would have to stop. She didn't say.
She said stop doing comedy.
She said stop.
Yeah. Well, then I apologize.
I want you to be at home.
Yeah. And I'll take care of your boys.
And I'll take care of it. I'll put money in your account every month. And I'm like, oh, I don't want to do that.
Fuck. That sounds horrible.
She bought me a car.
Porsche? You know what? Porsche? Seriously, do you have a magic dick? I'm just going to put it out there, Mike.
No.
Are you hung like a troll?
No.
What's going on here? You got women saying, no. Stop your profession. Just be my sex boy. Just be my boy.
I think because I'm just like loose as a goose about everything. You know, I'm just like.
It's refreshing.
Whatever you want to do, you know. If you want your butt licked, I'm good with that.
Just make sure it's clean.
No, I don't
care. No, come on, Mike.
It's got
you got to put that
it,
in there.
It's got a little tank, man. You want to get a biscuit at that point. Stop it.
Your corporate status is gone.
We thought it was bad before. Oh, God.
Oh, man. Southern boys.
Jeff's going to be like,
I'm just kidding.
It was Southern good until like the tank comment, when the tank comment came out.
You don't like a tank?
No, no, I love the tank.
Okay.
Me too.
Fine. Now, like, here's smell to it, like a little, just a little bit.
I'm with you. Who
little
cares?
Bit of ass.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know what? Mm. This is a great question to ask the player.
I'm not a player.
Come on now, no. Michael.
No. Well, because a player is not honest. I'll give you that.
Okay, fine. He's not a player, yeah. But he's been with plenty of women. And
yes,
my,
I have done that.
My contention is every woman is different.
Yeah.
You go to throw
Southern
some moves.
Are different than like Midwest women.
Yeah?
Midwest women are a little rougher.
Yeah?
And Southern women are more crazy.
Okay. They'll You're going to have to describe the difference between crazy and rough.
Like Midwest women, they like to like wrestle around while they're doing it, you know?
Okay.
Like on the floor, on the bed, and on the table, and, you know, in the bathroom. And
Todd's like, that's never fucking happened to me. I don't know what.
Absolutely,
which,
it's happened.
Which part of Midwest are you talking about? Because I haven't been in that part yet.
And Southern women are more like Bronco riders, you know?
Normal or reverse?
Both.
But they, Bronco, period. Yeah.
You know, and Northern women, I just kind of stay away from them.
Because they're crazy?
No, they're just too uptight. They're like, oh, yeah, well, y'all do that kind of stuff down there? You know, I'm not going to do that. It's nasty. You know? I'm like, really? Okay, see you. Gone. You know? But Midwest women, they seem horny. I don't know what it is, but like Wisconsin, Iowa, I mean, just all through the Midwest, Nebraska, they just seem like they're horny all the time. It's like.
I haven't bumped into any of those either.
Now,
God damn it.
Come on. Don't you think that's kind of a new, maybe it's not a new phenomenon, but because.
I think they're pinned in so much because it's cold.
I think because of technology with the internet and things like that, there's an avenue, there's an outlet for women to kind of get out there and meet different people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right?
Or read or all, think of all the, you know, 50 Shades of Grey shit you can read and, you know, you can get off that way. You don't have to necessarily
do
anything.
Yeah, I mean, really, if you just want to stay in the house, you can punch up naked women, any color you want, anything, any religion, whatever, and they're going
to
be
women. You know, I've been thinking about the idea of having to talk to my two youngest boys who are 9 and 11.
About what?
About the easy access to porn.
I mean, don't know. That might be a little bit too young.
No.
Hold on a second.
I'm not
if
having
Mike
a conversation
is saying,
with him, right? Wait, hold on a second. Because he's assuming.
I think you might have crossed a moral line here.
I'd say 14, 15.
He's saying that 9 and 11. No, I'm saying I'm thinking now about down the road when I had a conversation that porn is so accessible.
Oh, yeah.
I remember when I used to type in like boobs and just would like scroll to see what up because nothing would come up.
Listen, you know? When we were 16, there was nothing like the internet.
No, I remember when it was just starting.
Yeah,
and
that was when I was 21, 22. Yeah.
Right.
You know, and I would be like, okay, my wife just left to go get groceries. And I'd type it in and I'd be like, line.
Right.
I'm almost at a nipple. God damn it. You know?
Erase history.
Yeah, erase history. And we talked about that too, because nowadays on smartphones they have incognito mode, which, I mean, call it what it is, jerk off mode. You know, right. It erases your history from anything that you've gone from that point
forward. I think every guy likes to look at naked women on the internet. I don't care how old you are or whatever.
You know what?
Our wives learned early on that's just.
And see, my ex-wife thought it was disgusting. She thought you should go to jail if you looked at it.
Really?
Oh, wow. She was very prudish on that kind of stuff.
Well, you know, it says something, though, that she was prudish about it, but you guys had sex every day.
Yeah, and anything went because she felt like we were married, so anything would go.
Right.
Know? I mean, I'd come home and there'd be candles all over the room and, you know, all that kind of
sweet.
Stuff. You know?
And then you knock the fucking candles over as you're
choke on that shit.
Oh, wait a second. Hold on a second. No, the candles were beautiful. It was a lovely sentiment. Wipe that stuff off your face.
I used to do a joke. I go, I think my wife thinks I'm cheating on her. After we had sex, I got up and started putting on my clothes and promised her I'd call her.
Dude, can you imagine what would happen? If you just played that shit out. No,
that'd be
if
so
you were to,
funny. God, that'd be great.
If you were to take 10% of what all comics say, just take 10% of what all comics say and actually try to live that shit out.
Or just one time, just when your wife goes, get up, say, it's okay, she thinks I'm at work. See what happens. And laugh real quick.
For sure.
That's taking the, you know, when somebody goes, oh, Sarah. Oh, I'm sorry. When you scream out the, when you
well,
scream
you
out the wrong
that's
name.
That's happened to me like 10 times.
Dude, I can only imagine what the
how
fuck
can you keep it straight?
Well, there was, I was
the
with
safe
girl
word
one
would
night.
Be, oh, woman, you just did it for me.
And she goes, what's my name? We're laying there. And I said, honey. And she goes, no, tell me, what's my name? And I said, I have no idea. And I'll never forget it to this day. Her name was Fausta.
Fausta?
Yeah.
Fausta.
Are you shitting me? Who the fuck is named Fausta?
Well, see, and I couldn't
one
remember.
Person.
Well, see, my one son called me one time, and he goes, hey, Dad, you with somebody? And I go, yeah. He goes, and she's laying right there, and he goes, did she touch you? And I went, yes. He goes, put me on speakerphone. Where'd she touch you, Dad? And I went, all over. He goes, Dad, you're not the monster. She is. He goes, she started putting on her clothes. And he goes, I'm going to point at a doll, and you tell me where she licked you. And I went, all over, all over. I feel dirty. And he goes, no, Dad, no. She's the beast. When she starts walking out the door, and I went, hey, Adam, it worked. She slams the door, and I go, hey, Adam. I said, you got $5 on you? And he said, yeah. And I go, your $5 to my 500. She knocks on the door in 5 minutes. So he started counting down. 3 minutes later.
Here's the crazy fucking thing. That, I'm sure, happened.
Oh, yeah.
And that never will happen. Well, you know what? It hasn't happened yet. I'll just say it hasn't happened yet. Because I'm sure Mike, 6 years ago, never thought that that would have happened.
Oh, no.
Right.
You know what? I met her. She was a cop, and she had pulled me over.
The woman that left and came back in 3 minutes?
And she said, where are you going? I said, well, don't write me a ticket, because that just means that much less money I got to spend on you. That's how we met.
That's how it started?
Well, the one cop that I was dating, she pulled me over at 3 o'clock in the morning in Louisville, because I don't stop for lights.
Yeah, who does?
Yeah, not 3 o'clock in the morning.
Public safety. Come on.
I ain't
there's no
all that stuff. Well, she pulls me over, and she goes, boy, you ran about 10 lights. And I said, yeah, I know. I said, she goes, you've been drinking? I said, no, I'm careless. I don't care about all that silly stuff.
I don't care about rules,
citizenship. Who has
she
ever
goes,
heard of that?
Oh, I know you. She goes, I was at your show 3 weeks ago. I got a picture with you. And I said, she goes, you don't remember me, because she's real. I said, turn around.
Dude, who's got the balls to say that to a cop as they
goes,
pull
you go have coffee? And I go, sure.
Perfect.
God bless you, sir. Yeah. You might be my new favorite human being.
I just don't care. I'm not afraid to go to jail either. I tell everybody that.
Oof.
I got bond money, man. I could care less.
I've never been to jail.
Now, Todd, honestly, we're going to have to wrap things up here shortly. Mm-hmm. But can you imagine?
Absolutely.
No, you can't. Fuck. No. Very few people could imagine how liberating.
That's the word I was thinking of.
And freeing that type of mentality can be. And he has only reached that mentality. And how old did you say you were? You're barely over 40. Yeah, barely over 40.
But I think, he's the one who said that hopefully in a marriage. If anything, you should be able to be that open and that honest about some of those things if you're married.
If you should be.
You should be, if you're not already.
But you can't.
You don't think you can be?
No.
Why not?
You should be, but you can't.
Because you can't tell them the truth, or they'd be worried all the time about bills or whatever, you know? And it's better just to take the pressure on yourself.
I was talking about fucking.
Oh, fucking, yeah.
Everything well, you are so obsessed with the fucking part.
I think everything. No. But, you know, when you got bills and if there's pressure, if they have pressure, then they don't want to do it because they're thinking tomorrow.
They're thinking about all these other things.
Yeah, what happens? If, they're what-if people.
And sex is one more chore you got to do. Yeah.
So I never would let my wife handle the bills or none of that kind of stuff. I handled all that. Her money was her money. Whatever she made at work went in her account. She got to spend it. So there was never any money issues. I took care of all the bills, you know.
Wow.
She never even Facebook had to pump gas in her car.
Facebook fucked that whole thing up.
Well, you know what?
Jesus.
And she's got crazy. A boyfriend, but he's a broke-ass country boy. And I told her, I said, everything you always hated, that's what you have right now.
Yeah.
You got a broke-ass country boy. And he's a good guy.
And you're living with, and she's living with her mom.
Yeah. And he was at the wedding, and I just told him, I said, listen, I ain't got nothing against you. And I really don't. I said, but you ever interfere with one of my kids?
Sure.
I said, then it's a gunfight. And if you kill me, that's fine.
And I used to be a police officer.
And I'll kill.
I'm a good shot.
I want you to know, don't say you're looking for me because I'm looking for you already. And he said, deal. And actually, me and him are kind of good friends, really. We're not good friends, but...
Mike, I like you a lot. I got to say that. I'm just going to put it out there
right
now. I
try to get him to marry her. I go, man, the priest is already there going up.
Yeah, you got one ready to go.
And he goes, I ain't marrying her. See what happened to you? I go, exactly. You know what your punishment is? I said, your punishment is you have to wake up with her every once in a while. That's your punishment. And I go, because he moved out, this guy moved out my fishing stuff and took my tools out of my house.
Son of a bitch.
And I go, what kind of guy does that to another guy?
You don't take tools from another man.
And I go, that shows
man.
Me you're whipped right there. That she said, take those tools, take that fishing stuff. And you said, yes. I said, I should kill you for that.
Yeah.
I said, but your punishment is
fucking you got that pissed me off.
And I truly believe that's his punishment, is he has to listen to her, and I don't have to anymore.
I guess so. Mike, I have to tell you, I appreciate you very much, your honesty, and I appreciate your – I do. It's very liberating. It's liberating, and I appreciate the way you're approaching life. It makes me inspired, to be quite honest.
I've gotten in trouble for being so honest.
Oh, fuck that. It's not worth
I'll say this. I had a terrible day at work.
No, I hope
you and have I got here late, and I was off my game. At the beginning,
so.
And job, I appreciate bud. The fact I had a wonderful time with you today.
I've had a great time.
It was a great time.
I don't even know what time it is. How long have we been doing this?
almost two and a half hours.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah, almost 3 hours. Yeah.
Oh, man. Good y'all, Lord y'all in heaven. $5,000 with me.
But
shit. Go tell your wife.
Jeff!
Jeff! Where are you?
Jeff knows. Jeff goes, man, you're up to 7,000.
Hey, you know what? He
charges $3,500 an hour.
I am gonna twist your noodle. I'm gonna ask you questions about other stuff to help this show be better.
I think what you're doing is great.
Thanks, buddy. We appreciate it.
I really think this is the best. Y'all should go national. I mean, just like get a lot of money for being doing it, because you're both good at what you do. Y'all play off of each other perfectly.
We've been around each other way too long.
Oh, way too long.
I'll tell you that. You messed with his wife, and good God.
That was a long time ago, too. Well, hey, we appreciate the compliments. We're always thinking about how we're getting better at it.
Thank God that cooter smelled good.
I don't think you need to improve at all.
Well, now we need to know how to take it to the next level. How do you take it to the next level? I don't even know how to do that.
Well, listen, we're going to let Mike go. And Mike, real quickly.
People like me telling everybody to listen to you.
Okay. I love that.
That's a great thing. Thank you very much for that.
On Facebook and go, you know. See, and that's what the beauty. I got 5,000 followers because that's all they allow me. But I'll put something on Facebook and everybody shares it. And it gets shared 100 times. And then those people share it with other people. I mean. And that's why I sell out wherever I go. They go, oh, you only got 35 likes. I go, it'll be sold out over it because everybody's sharing it.
Right.
Know? Well, I love it. And what I also love, sir, all right, real quick, this podcast that you're on right now, it will air a week from this Monday.
Okay.
All right.
I won't listen to it.
No.
Because I can't stand to hear my voice.
Really?
Ugh. But what do you
never
have?
Never seen myself on TV or nothing. Really? Ugh, it just horrifies me. I've got a couple of CDs. I've never even heard them.
Really?
Ugh.
And see, I don't mind it at all. Not that you don't see my face at all, but I don't mind the sound of my voice. And I
feel like I sound like old hillbilly or something.
Well, you do, but you sound like a really sexy old hillbilly.
You're smart.
I'll tell you what. I tell Todd every now and then, I'm like, have you watched the latest show? Are you sure you're watching what I'm doing? Because I got to go through and I edit. You know, I try to go through and I keep the best parts, or I try to get rid of things that are bad. And I go, are you sure you've watched this? Have you watched this?
I watch it all the time.
Because I watch it and
I listen to it. I'm right. Listen, I listen
you can
to
watch
it.
Yourself and you're like, oh, God damn.
Yeah, I can't stand it.
I'm with you, it though. If you don't like something, it's like, oh, fucked up there. What are you going to do? And you move on. Know,
one night I was on Showtime, HBO, and CMT all the same night, and I was horrified. I wouldn't even turn on the TV because I was afraid I might accidentally
see yourself.
All right, so this is kind of an interesting thing. So as a comic, you never videotape yourself and watch yourself and then critique it?
No. Never.
Never.
I don't care. You're only as good as your next show. That's the way I've always felt about it. You know, you might get a standing ovation, but that ain't going to help you the next show, you know. You never know. Different crowd.
I let you go. But when you said that you kind of blew it on Bob and Tom the first time, when did you ever get to the – do you still get to the point where you're like, oh, that was not such a good show, or it didn't go as well? I mean, they go pretty well now.
I've gotten to the point on that show where I don't have to be funny.
How about just stand-up, period? That you just are – you just yourself and you don't never go up there and bail?
I've never ate it.
Really?
I know that sounds weird, but I've never had a bad show.
Oh, that's great.
I might have had a couple of bad people in the audience, but I don't deal with them. I let the bodyguards or the bouncers deal with them. You know, that's not my job to control anybody.
So hecklers don't really bug you too bad.
You know what? I'm one of those fast paced. I do one liners.
Okay.
And I'm just like bam, 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 and it's hard for people to heckle me.
Sounds like your sex as well. Bam, bam, bam.
I've been heckled.
They call me. They call me the rabbit.
Get that thing out of my ass, Mike. Listen,
I told you it was coming. I told you it was coming.
I was up
this
front.
This should not surprise you
over
at
dinner,
all.
You knew it was going to happen.
Yes. I've been completely honest with you.
People will be going, Mike Armstrong said that?
Damn right he did. He knows exactly who he is.
Now listen, today is Thursday, February 5th. Mike will be performing at Penguins this weekend.
Yes.
Yes, sir. What is coming up in the future for you? Is there anything that you want to like promote?
Fox thing coming out. And
with Fox, when you say Fox, can you what, there's so many
Fox.
Like so many,
you know what?
Foxes.
You shrug your shoulders like, it's nationwide. Everybody
fucking television.
Yeah,
fuck it. Goddamn TV. You
know, it's just going to be more pussy for me when I go to Vegas next time.
If the check don't bounce, I'm good, you know?
And I mean, when you say Fox, so there's like 10 different Fox channels now. Like, is it like.
It's the main Fox channel.
Okay.
You know, and they'll show it.
Look how nonchalant he is.
I'll make some money. I'll get fucking laid.
One of these days.
This is another day for me.
One of these days, you and I are going to be able to go,
but you know what? CMT offered me a part on a show. And I go down and they said, well, we want you to audition. I said, I ain't auditioning. I ain't going to go to audition. And they're going, well, we'll give you $80,000 if you sign. And I go, I've read it. And I go, man, this is crap. This is too much to remember. I said, I ain't doing this. And they're going, you're kidding me. I go, give me a part with a wacky neighbor next door. Three lines. I go, I don't want to remember all this. I go, it's a job.
Right.
I'm not going to sit there and spend 15 hours a day. Oh, I hope I get my lines right. I don't care.
You got to enjoy your life a little bit. I mean,
I did two commercials for them, and we shot one 5 times. And the last one, I never said a word. I just made faces. And they said, that's the one we're going to use. Because I was like, I am tired of this crap. You know?
Oh, I bet.
And they were going, and it was this girl was getting her own show, and she wanted me to do the commercials with her. And she's really a good person. The blonde-headed girl on Reba McEntire's show.
Yes.
Well.
I can't remember her name actress-wise, but.
Melody or whatever it is. But anyway, me and her are pretty good friends. And she goes, come down here and shoot this commercial. So the deal was I was supposed to be walking across the stage. And she goes, oh, Mike, guess what? I'm getting my own sitcom, blah, blah, blah. And I go, ah, blah, 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 blah. And they go, okay, now try it from the – I'm like, you know, this is turning into a job. I'm looking at her going,
There's goes, expectations on this paycheck. This is bullshit.
So finally she's telling me and I'm going, I'm looking at her boobs the whole time. She's got big ones. I'm going, and she goes, what are you thinking? I went, ugh, and I walk away. And that's the one they use. And my son, when they shut, he goes, Dad, you never said a word, but it was just funny. The way you was like hawking her boobs, and then you just went, ugh, and walked away. And I went, no more. Not doing no more.
Now, that an excellent example of what we all should strive for. Yeah. Not necessarily
not giving
staring
a shit
at a woman's boobs and going, ugh. But,
or not giving two fucks about anything.
But you should live your life that you enjoy it. Every day you enjoy it. If you have to wake up and you're stressed and you're worried about the bullshit that somebody else is putting on your shoulders, figure a different way.
Yeah, absolutely.
Figure out a different way. Other people have done it and other people are having a great fucking time. And you don't have to have the stereotypical marriage. You don't have to have the stereotypical lifestyle. If you want to bang sisters,
do it.
Do it.
And have the balls to ask.
And don't take a buddy who's got a cock block you to Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
Bing. Bang,
I wonder
boom.
Who that could be.
Don't ever take Todd.
Now, Mike's only going to think of me as a cock blocker. I don't like this image that I'm leaving with him.
No, I think you've grown out of it.
I have. We're married. Can't cock block anything anymore.
Well, I mean, I envy you guys that you got good wives and you love them.
Well, thank you very
much,
Mike.
I appreciate that.
I wish I could find one.
Good ladies.
Well, we hope the same for you, if that's what you want.
No, it's never going to happen. I know.
You're done.
You know what?
You know, again, like I said, you're 32
years. He might wish that
for
you, Mike, but I wish that you keep banging those different ladies.
You know what?
I want you to do what makes you happy. I don't give a shit.
Well, like my sisters and all them at Christmas, they said, you know, you're going to be the guy at the old folks' home just trying to nail every nurse you can get. And I go, I hope so.
That sounds
Hey, you know what? When you think about it, once people get to that old folks' home, what are the odds that you're married person is still with you?
Well, 60 Minutes just did a thing on people who are living in old folks' homes now, the nicer places. That's the highest level of STDs right now in the nation because they're all grown crazy.
Getting freaky.
And they're not going to have to live with it that long, so why not?
Right. Well, it's like my grandfather.
God damn it, I got mustard coming out of my penis.
You're going to be dead in a year anyway.
My grandfather was a Methodist minister, and once my grandmother passed away, and they were lived in a very nice retirement home in Lodi, California, every time I saw him, I said, what are you doing tonight? And he goes, I'm going to go down and have dinner at the cafeteria. I'm like, oh, do you want to go have dinner somewhere? He's like, no, that's where I meet all the ladies at.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, sorry, Grandpa. I have this picture of him on a pedestal, obviously, and he's just like wants to go down and hang out with the ladies.
Why not?
Yeah. And it's the first time I was like going, okay, yeah, good for you. Do what you
got
to do.
I mean, they ain't got much time on earth. Why not have fun?
God damn right.
I hear you.
And ladies that think you're whores, embody that whore status and have fun. Fuck. Yeah. Have fun.
Why not?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's still going to be there when we're done, you know. Clean it up. Go to the next trip.
All right, so go
Vegas
check out.
Vegas, here we
know
come.
What? Go to Facebook and check out Mike Armstrong on Facebook. He's got two different Facebook things. He's got like the comedian Mike Armstrong, and then he's got, hey, I'm a family man, Mike Armstrong. Anyway, check him out. Go to his shows. Enjoy penguins. Anyway, when you watch this, he'll be gone. He'll have performed 2 weeks ago. It doesn't matter. But you know what does matter? The fact that I had a great time with Mike. It was a wonderful time meeting you tonight.
Oh, it was great. I feel like I made two good friends.
I sure hope so. We
had a damn right.
Time.
So when I Facebook you and I say, what are you doing tonight?
I'll message you.
Thank you. All right, honey.
I'll start sending you pictures.
I will show my wife.
Don't send me pictures.
I will show my wife the responses and go, Mike says we have to do this, honey.
Well, you know what? I do that every show. After the show, I pick couples, and I go, y'all look a little uptight. And I go, I want you to go home and do something nasty that you've never even thought about doing and let him do it to you. And I get messages, wow, she let me get her in the ass last night, you know, because you said that.
You know what?
That's what's going to keep him at home.
I really
your lips.
From your lips to these ears, mister.
I tell him, I go, that's what's going to keep him home.
Sweetheart, you got to listen to this podcast. You'll love it.
I can't.
You will love it.
I can't stress enough the fact that I really enjoyed Mike. And then this last couple minutes, I've really enjoyed Mike. He's got really sound advice. Here's some other sound advice. Go to Kickstarter.com. Go to Kickstarter.com. Type in TPSP. That's our Kickstarter fundraiser. It's only for this. Again, this will be posted a week and a half. You got like a week left.
Yep. Got about 15 days.
We have 17 backers. Our goal is $10,000 for better equipment.
Studio space,
live shows, things like that to produce a better show.
Yep.
For you guys out there, more entertaining.
You got it.
And for other people, not just for us. The Primal Scream, but for the Bandwagon, for the Count to Ten podcast, for the Metro High School project, for things like that. We're trying to give to other projects. So make sure you hit Kickstarter, type in TPSP, click on TPSP Productions. And give what you can. I really would appreciate it. I would say share it, but there's a lot of people sharing it. Give some money. It would really change my life if you did.
Yeah, absolutely.
It would make my life easier if you did. Todd.
Yeah.
If people are watching this episode on YouTube, where else could they watch it?
If you go to TPSP Productions.com. While you're there, you can go up to the toolbar at the top, and there's a click on shows. Underneath that is the primalscream.com. You can watch us right there on the spot. If you're not on YouTube and watching us, or if you're in your car and you want to listen to us, you can go to iTunes, Stitcher, type in the Primal Scream podcast, because there is the Primal Scream, the band out there. So the Primal Scream podcast will get you our link on Stitcher and on iTunes. You can download us. A lot of people listen to us on YouTube while they're working on their computers at work, at least people that I've talked to about it. But that's best way to find out about us while you're there on our Facebook on our production page. Go ahead and like us on Facebook, and when you're on Stitcher and iTunes, subscribe and review things for us. Give us feedback. We want to know what we're doing good and what we're doing bad, and give us suggestions. We're always trying to get better all of the time. So,
and if you have sex, make sure there's crime tape around the room. I want it that bad. I want it that much.
I'm just going to work really hard at getting wet from
right here. I
just want
to make, you know what? This is the first night I've met you, but I just want to make you proud. I do. I don't know why, but I want to get on Facebook and go, Mike, this is what happened last night. God damn it. You'll be proud of me.
I'm sopping wet from right here to right here.
Yeah. And Michael say, who the fuck is this?
No, I'll go, I'll get a tear in my eye.
A tear in your eye.
Yeah.
I'm so proud of you, Matt. You made her scream everything you were doing to her.
You're making him wet. It's perfect.
That's cool. It really is. Try it one time. Get a hotel room, though. You can't. You might wake the kids up. You
know, yeah.
I don't really care. That's fine. The kids can deal with some scarring. Yeah. So go to YouTube, go to iTunes, go to Stitcher, type in TPSP Productions, type in the Primal Scream Podcast. Check all that stuff out. Thank you very much, Matt, Jesus Christ. Thank you very much, Todd, for being with us tonight and starting this without me.
Hey, buddy.
You're the man.
We're backing each other up all the time. Don't worry about it.
I'm your training wheels, and you're the bike. I'll say that. How's that?
And you're the haul to my oats.
Oh, Jesus Christ. I don't want to be my oats.
You are oats.
I'm glad that you had the same reaction I did. The little bit of...
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, Mike Armstrong, for being here tonight. Check out Penguins Comedy Club and check out USA Entertainment to book your next comedian.
Yeah, it costs $5,000, but get me.
There you go. And he's fucking worth it. Yeah, I'll tell you what. Have him in for a candid conversation.
You never know what's going to happen.
You never know what's going to happen.
Yeah. Thank you, Mike, for your time.
Thank you.
Yeah, we really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. I'm Matt.
I am Todd.
And that's Mike Armstrong. We'll see you later.
Adios.
Good night.